Feels like a football Saturday again in Morgantown, West Virginia. Tailgating is back. The fans are back, and we have football. The Mountaineers and Long Island next. Welcome to the Big 12 now on ESPN Plus. In front of more than 50,000 fans, here come the Mountaineers with the fans back at Pushkar Field. We are ready to roll, and it is electric. Hi, everybody, alongside former Kansas State and 12-year NFL lineman Barrett Brooks. Bill Spaulding, glad to be with you. Hey, the atmosphere is great. This is what we missed last year, so we're ready to roll. But it's also a really big game for West Virginia to hit the reset button coming off the loss last week to Maryland. You know, head coach Neil Brown says he wants his team to be known as a physical bunch that doesn't beat themselves. Barrett, he thinks they failed on both accounts last week.
Absolutely. You know, in fact, he didn't just challenge his players. He challenged the coaches. He wanted to go back to fundamental football, going out there imposing their will on the offense and defensive lines, making sure they tackle, catch, run, basic fundamental stuff. So at this point, they have to make sure they play fundamentally sound in order to be for Wilson Brown to be happy about it.
Yeah, you see some of the numbers. The one that sticks out the most, the four turnovers. Neil Brown even said during the week, you cut those turnovers out, it's a different conversation after that game.
No question. You know, when they were running the ball well in the beginning of the game, then all of a sudden, they just started playing undisciplined. And at the undisciplined football, you can't beat anybody doing that.
And when they run the football well, it often starts with Letty Brown.
Absolutely. You're talking about a guy that runs well in between the tackles. But look, he can catch out of the backfield. He's a versatile running back. He understands that he is the best offensive player on this team, so they use him in that capacity. Look, he runs in between the tackles well, gets that tough yardage, especially in the end zone and in red zone situations.
All right, and who's on the other side here? It's a team you may not know. In just their third year in Division I football, they come out of the FCS. It is the Sharks of Long Island University. Tough test here for Jonathan Gill, the interim head coach, and his squad.
Absolutely. You know, you have a West Virginia team that's a little mad right now, but they have to go out there and play their game. They just lost a tight game. They have to go out and play fundamental football. And they also understand that they run an option, and West Virginia doesn't really see the option as much. So they feel as though they have a chance, but just going to have to play well, disciplined ball to beat this West Virginia team.
All right, the fans are ready. We're ready. Now all that's left, kickoff. Let's play football coming up in just a bit. We get things going. The Mountaineers and the Sharks from an electric. We've been seeing the traditions coming back across college football this season. And here's one at West Virginia. It's called the Mountaineer Man Trip. About 2 hours before kickoff, walk through the parking lots where the tailgate's happening, touch that big piece of coal to pay homage to the coal mining history here in West Virginia. And then the really nice touch here at the end, they turn back toward the West Virginia Children's Hospital and wave to the kids in the hospital looking out the window.
That is big time. That's unbelievable. You want to show support, especially for those kids in there. I love that they do that.
There's starting quarterback Jared Dagey. He and the Mountaineers will get the ball first here. West Virginia won the toss, chose to return, which means we get to look at Winston Wright right out of the chute. Averaged 42 yards a return last week against Maryland.
Dynamic in every way, returning the ball. In fact, he was the bright spot in that game, a really bright spot in that game. So if he can go out there, establish it from the beginning, West Virginia wants to go out there, impose their will, and start this game off the right way.
Right at that 98-yard return all the way down to the Maryland 2, set up a touchdown in the first quarter. Had another couple where he looked like he was about to break it as well.
A shoestring away a lot of the time.
Paul Inzerello, the senior from Staten Island, to kick it away for Long Island. Largest crowd anyone on the Sharks roster has ever played in front of. Away we go in week two. Here comes Winston Wright from the 11. That's a good seam. Winston Wright down the chute. Winston Wright is gone. What a start. Touchdown, West Virginia.
Set up the wedge perfectly. That's the way to start off a game. So here you go, Bill. You get the crowd into the game early. He was a threat last week. He finished the deal this time.
It's officially a 90-yard return. And the legend of Winston Wright on kickoff returns just keeps on growing.
Definitely.
Point after coming for Casey Legg. I have to say that is one of the best names for a kicker in all of college football.
No doubt, though. Casey Legg.
Redshirt Jr. took over the starting job last year after Evan Stanley's injury, and he has kept it since. Oh, it's a bad snap, but he got it to go.
Sometimes things just fall your way, and right off the bat, the Mountaineers return a kick.
Nine-yard return.
And when you watch it, look how they set it up in front. They set the wedge up in front. He follows his blockers and then explodes out. Once he got free, there was no way this kicker was going to stop him. He showed speed throughout last week. He just finished the deal this week.
Junior from Savannah, Georgia, nearly had a touchdown last week. He was stopped at the two, all the way to the house this week. And we're 11 seconds in. Hit 7-0 Mountaineers.
This is exactly how they wanted to start things off, with a great play. Get the fans involved. You know, all these people want to see what this West Virginia team was. They fell short last week. They have to close it this week.
So, Long Island, what are you made of here now? Get hit in the mouth 11 seconds into this game, a game where you're already huge underdogs. How do you respond in this situation?
They're going to have to go back to stick to fundamental football. They run the option. They have to use their quarterback in a way in which they can, you know, go out there and use his athleticism.
Shamar Paul is deep for Long Island from the five. Oh, he's clobbered. Only to the 14, Lance Dixon, the redshirt sophomore, smoked him.
I heard that way up here. They stayed in their lanes. Tackle them inside the 20. Starting things off right here in Morgantown.
So it's a 9-yard return. Tough field position coming for Long Island. Sharks enter off a 48-10 loss to Florida International last week. Did have some moments on offense. Camden Orth, their redshirt freshman quarterback, seemed pretty composed on a couple of first half drives.
Absolutely. You know, he's an athlete. He knows what his strength is. He's running the ball.
Jonathan DeBeek is the lone setback top running back for this Long Island squad. Takes the handoff on first down, going nowhere. Gain of about one.
See, this is a tough defense to play against. It's a 3-3-3 defense where they have three defensive linemen and three linebackers. But they line the linebacker up on the line, so it looks like it's four. They're going to have to play fundamental football to really block everybody and hold everybody accountable for getting their guy north of his office to run.
Yeah, Orth started well, 11 for 18 in the first half last week, just 4 for 12 in the second half when a 28-10 halftime deficit turned into that 38-point loss against the Panthers. Screen it to the outside. Tussin Oyekonmi with a decent gain of about 7 before Alonzo Adai takes him down. The flag is out. Came out well after the play.
They can't hurt themselves. Let's hope it's not on this LIU team. Don't beat yourselves. That's the only way they can consider themselves staying in it, if they don't beat themselves.
After the play was over, personal foul, number 29, defense, 15 yards added to the end of the run, automatic first down.
That's fifth-year senior Sean Mahone tagged for the personal foul. One of the leaders of this Mountaineer defense gives a first down to Long Island here.
Well, you know, they had a lot of accepted penalties last week. This is what Coach Brown preached the entire week. Play fundamentally and don't beat yourselves. And this is exactly how you beat yourself, with silly penalties like this.
Neil Brown thought up front Akeem Messidor was great last week for West Virginia. Wanted to see more physicality from the rest of that talented D-line. It's DeBeek again on first down, shouldering into the defense for about 4. Jonathan DeBeek, one of the keys for this Long Island offense. And then on the outside, Derek Eugene is a legit wide receiver for the Sharks.
No question. The big senior. Make sure he's the guy that they beat deep. He's going to take the top off the defense. And then, you know, at this point, DeBeek is a guy that can run in between the tackles. He's explosive. He's going to have a good game in order for this Long Island team to go out there and really establish themselves as somebody that can, you know, compete in this game.
next important drive here for Long Island. Already one first down, steadying the tide after the kick return touchdown to start the game for Winston Wright in West Virginia. Fourth quick hitter there is the aforementioned Derek Eugene, who is hit behind the line. Alonzo Adai for the second time this drive comes up from safety. The West Virginia team just full of defensive talent, and the coaches have rave reviews for the sophomore Akeem Messidor up front.
No question, Akeem Messidor out of Canada. This guy has it all the tantrums to be a great, not just at this level, at the college level, but also on Sunday. Speed, quickness, and he's got that thunk that you want as an aggressive guy up front.
And then Sean Mahone made 11 tackles last week, already called for that early penalty today.
He is a box safety. He's a guy that plays at linebacker level. He's an impact player because he's going to play right around that line of scrimmage and make some plays.
It's third and 10. Time for Orth underneath. Stephen Chambers hauls it in well short of the first down. About a 5-yard gain. Long Island has to punt.
Well, there was a little hope, you know, that they were able to move the ball effectively against this West Virginia defense. Consider the fact, you know, up front, this is where their strength is, the guys up front. So at this point, I see them as a team really that really needs to stay focused on being assignment correct.
Paul Inzarello out to punt. Punted an average about 33 yards a kick last week. Grayson Malashevich, former walk-on out of Cerrito, West Virginia, back to return. Oh, this is a shank off the side of the foot. And skitters down with a nice Sharks roll to the 21. So that is a 34-yard punt. Decent field position for West Virginia. And we'll get our first look at Jarrett Dagey and the Mountaineer offense when we come back. It's in the Big 12 this week. BYU, Cincinnati, Houston, and UCF set to join the conference in the next few years. BYU will join 2023. Up for debate whether Cincinnati, Houston, and UCF will join in 2023 or 2024.
Definitely, it'll definitely be an upgrade, especially with Cincinnati. They've been a powerhouse for a long time in the AAC. I look for them to go in and look at BYU. At this point, they can come in and be establish themselves in a Big Five conference. So, I mean, they're looking forward to that.
It does expand the footprint westward into Utah as well.
Westward expansion, huh?
This is the first drive for the West Virginia offense, led by quarterback Jarrett Dagey, the redshirt senior. Mountaineers scored on the opening play of the game, a Winston Wright kickoff return touchdown. Yeah, this is how analytical coaches can get. But Neil Brown said 62 offensive snaps for Jarrett Dagey last week. Thought he was good on 50 of them, but he said those 12 bad snaps were what determined the game.
Yeah, it's never about you know, the good snaps. It's always the bad snaps will be highlighted on that.
It's Letty Brown for a 2-yard gain. And these coaching staff still very high on Jarrett Dagey, the redshirt senior from Lubbock. They think he runs the offense well. Think that in general he's a good tempo guy to run this team as well. So he is firmly the starter as he fires a first down pass to Winston Wright. Moves the sticks with a gain of about 18.
The coaches said they want to establish the run first, and that gives you the ability to pass. That just goes to show they looking for them to run the ball and able to get a pass over the top on a crossing route.
Wanted fast tempo today, much faster than they played against Maryland. Letty Brown with a big chunk. 9 yards for Brown, the only running back to touch the ball last week. Expect to see Tony Mathis, Justin Johnson, and Avarius Sparrow in the backfield today.
Yeah, you look at the guys up front, you know, the guard, center, and guard have to establish themselves in the middle. If they can move the ball and those tackles join along, it'll be a really tough day for that front four of Long Island.
On second and one, Dagey goes underneath. There's Bryce Ford Wheaton. It's another first down. 4-yard gain ahead of Tyler Tobias, backup cornerback for a Sharks defense that got gashed last week. Gave up more than 11 yards of play, more than 12 yards a rush last week against Florida International.
Wow, they're going tempo again. I think they're trusting those tackles to be able to block the ends. Last week it wasn't the same. They had a tough day against that Maryland defensive ends.
Here's Letty Brown, and he's stuffed. Ben Wagboga, the junior from Columbia, Maryland, there to make the tackle at the line of scrimmage.
Well, he showed some last week. But this week, if you look, they ran a trap play. They would get up the field and make a play.
So it's second and 10 as Dagey changes the play at the line. Plenty of time to throw. Dagey taking a shot, looking for Bryce Ford Wheaton. Oh, he's crushed, and the ball pops out. Really good recovery defensively from Tariq Sneed, the junior cornerback. Got some safety help from Jerome Brooks.
And they run a man-to-man, and they were able to go over the top with that simply because they had two people in the same zone. It might have been a different pitch if they had different route selection on that play.
Three runs, three passes to start this game for West Virginia. Jared Parker, the offensive coordinator, said ideally 60-40 pass run if things are going the way they want it. On third and 10, it's Brown, upended. So they go to the draw on third and long, gain just two. An early decision for Neil Brown, fourth and 9 from the Long Island 44.
I'll tell you what, this Long Island defensive line, they're creating separation by pushing up the defensive offensive line and stopping them right there at the line of scrimmage.
Didn't take long to make the decision. Right. Going for it here. You like that call?
Not really.
Well, fourth and 9 from the 44. Dagey over the middle. It's a first down. Bryce Ford Wheaton. Gain of 22.
And this is a product of the head coach liking the fact that his tackles can block out there by themselves. Last week it was a lot harder from them. They had better athletes. But this week, he is trusting the fact that his offensive line can stop that diesel line of the Sharps.
Yeah, Brandon Yates, left tackle. Parker Moore, right tackle. And Wyatt Milam, who will also see it, right tackle, did not have a great day against Maryland last week. Looking for more from them this week. Brown on first down, hitting the backfield again, and down he goes. Well, it's a stout-looking group this week from Long Island. Yeah, they had zero tackles for loss against Florida International.
They are creating a new line of scrimmage. Penetration kills all run plays, and they are definitely pushing that offensive line back 3 yards, which allows them to then get pressure on the running back.
And now down goes Dagey. So it has not been smooth sailing. Matthew Molina in for the sack.
I love the fact that these guys are saying, all right, you are the big West Virginia team, but we can play just as good up front.
We've already seen Tariq Sneed, big breakup earlier. Sean Kelly, big tackling linebacker. And there you saw the junior defensive end, Molina, with the first sack today for Long Island. So it's 30-19. West Virginia needs the 13. Dagey escapes. Here's a dump off to Wright. He wins the one-on-one battle. Winston Wright, first down, out inside the 5.
That just goes to show a guy like that is always explosive enough to make big plays all the time. What that happened? Look at what happened with the linebacker. He blitzed on the play. When he blitzes on the play, he's got to seal the deal. He's got to make the tackle on Dagey. But instead, gives him a little bit of an opportunity to get the ball downfield. And then you have Wright, who's a phenomenal athlete, beating the one-on-one and able to get that chunk yardage they need to move the sticks.
It's Caleb Caslow, who had that shot at the sack, came up empty. First and goal from the 3. Dagey to throw, jump ball forward, Wheaton, he brings it down. No, it's incomplete, popped out at the end. It was in his mitts before Tyler Tobias ripped it out.
This is kind of it's almost like he doesn't trust, Coach Brown does not trust his offensive line to move this defensive line of Long Island off the ball. So what does he do? He passes on this. But what do? You go to your best player right now on the outside. Wright has been doing a great job of being that guy to go out there and make big plays. He looked to him a little too much this time. They were to make a play for Long Island.
13th play of this drive. It's gone 77 yards. Second and goal. Letty Brown. Close to the goal line, down at the 1. Dylan Cook there for the tackle. There has not been that huge push up front that the Mountaineer coaching staff is looking for yet.
No, he hasn't. And, this is an offensive line that outweighs this defensive line by about 20, 30 pounds.
On third and goal, it's Brown again. This time he's in. West Virginia has 4 offensive touchdowns this season. Letty Brown has all 4 of them.
Go with the best player on your offense, Letty Brown. Make those guys up front make their money today. Call upon them to do it. They move the defensive line, move the line of scrimmage, and allow him to go up there and push his way through in the middle of that defense. Letty Brown, their best offensive player, making a play.
Now they had to work for it. 14 plays, 80 yards, about 5 minutes of game time. But the Mountaineers pull ahead by two scores. Big fourth down conversion near midfield. And then Letty Brown finishes it off with his fourth touchdown already this season. And the Mountaineers are up two scores early. Letty Brown caps a 14-play, 80-yard drive with his fourth touchdown of the year. The Mountaineers lead 14-0 midway through the first quarter. College football action continues tonight, 7 Eastern on Big 12 Now on ESPN+. Three more matchups on the way. Texas Southern takes on Baylor. Southern Illinois travels to Kansas State. And Stephen F. Austin faces off with Texas Tech. For all Big 12 Now on ESPN+ content, sign up at ESPNplus.com/Big12Now. All right, your alma mater, Kansas State. Great start last week against Stanford. How are you feeling about where they sit right now?
If you look at that team, they're kind of iffy in what they have going on, but hey, they beat a tough Stanford team and it really getting things going in the right direction for them as a unit. Today's a big day for the Big 12, period.
Second chance of the football here for Shamar Paul and Long Island. And again, Paul is stopped at the same exact spot. The 13-yard line, tough field position for LIU once again. It was Lance Dixon on the second straight kickoff with the coverage.
Well, you look at it, this should be a strength for this West Virginia team. Get your best athletes out there, pin them back, and that's exactly what's happening.
So here comes Camden Orth to lead this offense again. Redshirt freshman from Newberry, Florida. He said this week to us that he is a young quarterback who still has a lot of growth in front of him. But Barrett, I was pretty impressed watching him on tape last week. What about you?
Oh, absolutely. You know, he showed the ability to run. He's a great athlete, but he also can throw the ball pretty well. And he has some targets that he can go to out in the outside. You know, Derek Eugene is somebody he can look to.
Orth said he lives by the motto, gritty, not pretty. And if LIU is going to pick up first downs today, they need to be gritty against these big physical Mountaineers. Shamar Paul and Jonathan DeBeek, both in the backfield here. And it goes to Shamar Paul around the edge using his speed for a solid gain on first down. Picks up 5.
You know, I'm shocked that they're trying to run the ball to the outside considering the athletes that they have for West Virginia. This is more of a team that I think that should run up between the tackles simply because they're so fast and have so much speed at the linebacker position and safety position on the outside. Sometimes you have to run into the teeth of the defense in order to get some positive yardage.
That's what DeBeek's been doing all day. Big number 2 for Long Island. Meanwhile, Shamar Paul more the change of pace. Here on 2nd and 5, Paul lines up in the slot. Pitch it out to DeBeek. Looking to go east-west and not much there. It's a 1-yard gain, 3rd and 4 upcoming. Redshirt freshman Sean Martin there on the tackle. Coaching staff really high on what he can bring at defensive end.
No question. No, he has strength to push the ball up the field and create that separation from the offensive tackle. If you give him an opportunity to go one-on-one on offensive tackle, he'll beat him for the most part. But if you see right there, they're trying to toss it out and get penetration, get those guys from penetrating on the outside since they are getting so much push from the inside.
Martin was the top recruit in West Virginia 2 years ago, originally committed to North Carolina before the combination of Neil Brown and West Virginia offensive lineman Zach Frazier talked him into staying home. 3rd and 4. DeBeek escapes. Here's Orth pitching it forward, and it short hops the tight end Owen Glasgow. Nearly a really good creative play. Instead, it's a 3 and out.
Right, you know, and then at this point, they try to bring the ball on the outside, so they try to throw it at the last point. He's a good quarterback if you allow him to go out there and use his skill set of running the ball. As a passer, he's functional. So at this point, he's trying to figure out a way in which they can, you know, make positive gains on the outside with his receivers.
Sophomore Justin Hurtline to punt after a 34-yarder his first time. Isaiah Esdale signals for the fair catch. It gets bumped. Flag should come out, and it does.
A little bit of incidental contact, but that's just good by West Virginia pushing his opponent into the receiver on the play.
It's Victor Nelson who bumped the fair catch signaling Esdale. This should be glorious field position for West Virginia.
As if they needed it. They're starting to get a little more confident in that offensive line of West Virginia.
Kick catch interference. Kicking team. 15 yards from the spot of the foul. First down, timeout.
So West Virginia will be in plus territory when we come back. A costly penalty for the Sharks, and things starting to circle already. West Virginia up 14-0 and looking for more. Well, like most of college football folks, this week with heavy hearts in the 20-year anniversary of 9/11. And as you'd expect for a university based in Brooklyn, Long Island has been directly affected by 9/11. This was pregame, the captain's coming out. You see that fireman's hat with Company 21 on it. That's Owen Glasgow, the tight end, carrying the helmet of his dad's company. His dad, Keith, was a member of Ladder Company 21, passed away on 9/11 inside the towers. His company was one of the first to respond. Owen was 15 months old at the time, so a very meaningful day for him. Long Island also lost Bronco Pearsall, a Long Island alum, was an offensive lineman for LIU back when they were the pioneers of LIU Post. He, too, a firefighter who passed away on 9/11.
Unbelievable. You know, I can't believe it's 20 years ago.
Second drive today for West Virginia. They've scored on a kick return, scored on a Letty Brown one-yard run. And now Jarrett Dagey to throw on play action. Bryce Ford Wheaton wide open. It's a big gain. 32 yards. Dagey and Ford Wheaton have connected three times already today.
If you look at it, they flooded the zone going left to right on the play, which allowed him to go and went wide open free on that play. Now, this doesn't say much about the run game, and I don't think that Coach Brown has a lot of faith in that run game. You see him passing the ball more so than running the ball.
Screen it out to Letty Brown. Down to the 5, second and short. Well, on that first drive, there's a reason to worry a bit about the run game. Letty Brown carried it 7 times for only 10 yards.
Absolutely. You know, so that shows up front they're not getting enough push to push that LIU defensive line.
And not to belabor the point, but this is a Sharks defense that gave up 12 yards a rush last week against Florida International. Go to Brown again. And he inches his way closer to the first down marker, but still short. Third and less than a yard. Can get that first down at the 3.
Bill, this is a problem for West Virginia. They're not getting any push on the defensive line of the Sharks. Now, in order for this team to really think that they had some progress from last week, they have to run the ball and establish the run. At this point, LIU is getting penetration and is killing all these run plays.
Third and less than a yard. It's Brown again. First down inside the 2. Gains about 1. First and goal for the Mountaineers. It's crazy when you think about it, because here are the Sharks starters up front. They go 217, 256, 280, 270. That is not a Big 12 defensive line.
Absolutely not. You know, we have guys that are 300 pounds up front for West Virginia. They should be pushing these guys around, but it just goes to show. The Sharks come in with heart, and they feel as though they can compete with this West Virginia team.
First and goal from the 2. Dagey to throw, going up top. And he overshoots Sean Ryan, the junior wide receiver.
I'm going to tell you the truth. This Sharks defense is winning the line of scrimmage. They are pressing back this West Virginia offensive line back 3 yards every single play. Now, you cannot establish the run if you don't get any movement up front.
And you can start to hear the mumbles from the 50,000 or so here at Pushkar Stadium as well. Second and goal. Brown up the middle. He's into the end zone again. 5 touchdowns through 5 quarters this year for Letty Brown.
It was a great play. He was able to evade the penetration from the linebacker blitzing. And that's what they're doing. They're blitzing this West Virginia offense. They get the score, but I tell you what, Coach Brown is not really impressed by what his offense is doing. They wanted to be physical. They want physicality to reign the day today, and they definitely haven't done it. The Sharks' defensive line have definitely went out there and showed that they belong to play on the same field with West Virginia.
Here comes Casey Legg again for the point after. Smooth operation this time. It's 21-0. You know, that's the dichotomy of a game like this. Look, West Virginia's up 21-0. They're on their way to what looks like a lopsided win. Yet, there's a lot you can pick apart at this point from the Mountaineers' performance.
No question. It does not deflect on how this game is won in the trenches. It's not a game where West Virginia is just dominating this Long Island team. Remember, first we had the kickoff return. Now they went down and scored, but it had short fields. So at this point, I really think that they're going to have a huge conversation going into the second quarter and try to establish more so something at the line of scrimmage going into the rest of this game.
And if it feels like we're being harsh, well, the coaching staff has to be as well, because after this week, you got Virginia Tech coming here next week. Then you're at Oklahoma the week after that.
No question. Now, if we're talking about a Sharks team, and we have to be honest, the athletes that they have right now are competing with West Virginia, Big 12 athletes. So at this point, they have to show something. Now, they're going to have to turn the corner and become a more physical team if they think they're going to go in and win these next two games.
Now, the Mountaineer defense played solidly today, only one first down allowed over the first two drives. This is into the end zone, so the best starting field position of the day for LIU. Sharks fell behind 21-0 against Florida International last week, then ended up scoring 10 out of the next 17 points, make it 28-10 at halftime. See if they have any type of response here late in the first quarter.
I think they will, because they believe in themselves up front. They believe in their defense. Now if they can go out on the opposite side of the ball, establish the run, and I really think when they come out, they're going to try to run up the middle instead of trying to run to the outside, where all of what West Virginia's talent is as far as speed and tenacity. I truly believe that they can run the ball in the middle of this defense for West Virginia.
It's another emphasis for Neil Brown and for West Virginia defensive coordinator Jordan Leslie. Wanted more physicality up front from guys not named Akeem Messidor. They pointed out Taj Alston, Dante Stills. Wanted to get more snaps for Jordan Jefferson and Jalen Thornton and win the game up front again. Kevin Wilson at running back, and his first carry today goes nowhere. There's that penetration from the defensive line. Jalen Thornton in the middle of that, along with X-Ray Lowe, the redshirt junior linebacker.
I love how they run their defense. I mean, it's actually a 3-4 defense, but the way they play it, they play three down linemen and a linebacker that's virtually a defensive end that rushes, so they always bring four. But you also have a safety that's in the box, and he's a guy that's going to play on the line of scrimmage sometimes, and he's going to be the guy that's going to blitz a little bit at the time also.
Saw Thornton in there. Didn't get a lot of snaps last week. Jordan Leslie, the defensive coordinator, said that was because of all the sudden changes. Really threw off the rotation for West Virginia. Didn't give them a chance to get their second string D lineman into the game. Underneath the tight end, Owen Glasgow. First catch for the Penn State transfer, and some good work after the catch. Sets up third and very short. Third and less than one.
Well, I told you, Cam North, he's a versatile athlete. He was able to evade the rush, get past him, get the ball out of his hands, and get it to his playmaker.
On third and one, just enough for a first down.
That so offensive line believes in it. Yeah, I mean, that offensive line believes in their ability to block those guys up front. The more and more they allow this Sharks offense to stay in this game and create a little bit of movement, they're going to take advantage of this, and they probably will come back and score a little bit like they did against Florida National.
Orth gets that second first down today with the quarterback keeper. See Jonathan Gill looking on. Interim head coach after 17 years as the quarterback coach at Long Island, so he's been through the transition from Division II to Division I. Derek Eugene into the backfield. He has two catches today. They've both gone backwards. Two catches for a loss of 6 yards. After last week, 117 receiving yards.
Absolutely. They went to the well a couple of times too many. And you look at it, all of their offensive players were within the box. You know, they have nobody on the outside that feels like it can beat one-on-one on the outside. So you want your wide receivers to go out there and make a play. Get Derek Eugene an opportunity to go and make a play over the top of this defense. They're just playing zone for West Virginia. That zone allow you to get some deep digs in the middle of the field. A lot of, you know, the quick pass or the slants.
And that's it for quarter number one. So Long Island lets the quarter run out, and West Virginia takes a 3-touchdown lead into the second quarter. It hasn't necessarily always been pretty, but some big plays for the Mountaineers, including a Winston Wright kick return touchdown to start the game, have them off and running in front of the fans on a beautiful day in Morgantown.
Join
Very somber here between the first and second quarter, remembering 9/11. First, fans here at West Virginia recognizing the two members of the Long Island program, Keith Glasgow and Bronco Pearsall. And then Chris Gray, quarterback at West Virginia from 1987 to 1991, worked for Cantor Fitzgerald at One World Trade Center. He also passed away on 9/11. His family is here, and again, right now, the crowd on its feet applauding the two Long Island heroes who were firemen in the FDNY, and Chris Gray, whose family has since started the Chris Gray Scholarship Foundation, made a major impact over the last 20 years, remembering Chris since that tragic day.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I can't believe 19 bad people unified this nation. And I love the fact that they're, you know, memorializing these guys that, who gave their life, you know, during that time period.
And we'll see even more at halftime about how folks around college football remembering that day. And, you know, at this point, educating their players as well. At this point, about half the players on these rosters weren't even born 20 years ago.
It's crazy to think that, you know, I can remember where I was. You know, I had just been cut by Cleveland. And I was actually supposed to go on my way to a workout with the Denver Broncos at 5 o'clock that day. Of course, everything was canceled, but, you know, it was just crazy when that happened.
21-0 West Virginia as we start the second quarter with a 2nd-and-12 for the Sharks of LIU. Redshirt freshman quarterback Camden Orth under pressure. There's that escapability again. Orth making a play with his feet and makes something out of nothing, but a flag comes in late.
Deceptive speed. Camden Orth has a little bit to him now.
We'll hear from referee Scott Campbell for just the second time today. This is a Big 12 crew.
Ineligible man downfield, number 64, offense, 5-yard penalty from the previous spot, still second down.
And Barrett, as a former offensive lineman, when the quarterback gets scrambling like that, so hard to stay disciplined and not get downfield.
It is. You know, that's one of the bad things about being an offensive lineman. But look, he shows his capability. This is like the third time he's evaded the pass rush and tried to make a play. It's actually working for him. They might need to try to boot him out a little more just to give him an opportunity to get the ball down the field.
2nd-and-17. Chance here for the pass rushers for West Virginia to pin their ears back. It's coming again, screen underneath, and Tosin Oyekanmi sees it slip out of his fingers. 3rd-and-17.
They tried to lull West Virginia's defense to a double screen. They faked the screen to the outside and then tried to throw it up to the receiver underneath on the tunnel screen. In order for this team, this Sharks offense, to get something going, they're going to have to spread it out a little bit. Everybody's within the hash. Put your athletes outside and try to give them an opportunity to go one-on-one, maybe slants or digs in the middle of the field. It's open right now because they're running zone.
Long Island 1-for-3 on third downs today. West Virginia had 2 sacks last week against Maryland. Orth has plenty of time. Letting it go deep and just throws it away as after a while with great coverage downfield. He was out of time in the backfield. Sharks have to punt for a third time.
Great pass rush up front. They won the offensive line. They won the line of scrimmage this time. The defense got penetration, made it uncomfortable for Orr. He had to throw it away.
2 punts today, averaging 36 yards for Justin Hertline.
Yeah, we watched a couple of games, you know, and he's been averaging, what, about 40 yards a punt.
It's another bouncer right to Esdale. That's a risky play, and that's him only about a yard. So the West Virginia offense goes back on the field. That brings out the wide receiver core led by Bryce Ford Wheaton. And that Ford name has lived long in West Virginia football lore. His grandpa, Garrett Ford Sr., was one of the first African-American football players here at West Virginia, helped integrate the program. His uncle, Garrett Ford Jr., played in the glory days, late 80s, early 90s. And now Bryce Ford Wheaton, third generation for the Mountaineers. He said his family did not pressure him to go to West Virginia. In fact, they were really hands-off. But he said he grew up watching West Virginia, grew up rooting for West Virginia, and that's all he really wanted to do was go to West Virginia. So once that offer came, he knew that's where he was going to be. On first down, Daigie keeps it himself. I beg your pardon. Looks like Garrett Green is into the game for the first time. So Garrett Green, the backup quarterback, redshirt freshman from Tallahassee, Florida, into the game as we see Garrett Ford Sr.'s picture, which hangs outside the practice field. So Bryson, he gets to look at his grandfather every single day coming off the field.
That's got to be something, you know. Look at your grandfather up, memorialized in the stadium when you go to practice. You know, that's a big deal, you know. So it's no wonder why he put the Ford name into his name when he got here.
All right, so now third and six. And, hey, this is what a lot of Mountaineer fans were calling for this week. They wanted to look at Garrett Green out there with a lot of the starters. The redshirt freshman quarterback from Tallahassee completed three of his four passes last year and gets a drive here in the second quarter today.
Very athletic guy. Green can move around a little bit. They'll try to use his legs more so than anything.
And he picks up a first down with those legs. A gain of eight before he is just tattooed. Ben Wyboga, the junior linebacker, stuck him.
Very, very mobile quarterback. I believe if he does get an opportunity to throw the ball down the field, he's not as accurate. But, hey, I tell you what, this guy's an athlete, and he can make some plays, elongate plays, and give you an opportunity to push the ball down the field simply because he's a good athlete.
Justin Johnson in at running back, which, if you watched last week, something we didn't see much. Letty Brown got every single carry for the Mountaineers, and he had every carry in the first quarter as well. On the give to Sam James on the end around. James looking to turn the corner. He strung out well. No gain. Caslow strung him out. And then Tariq Sneed, strong quarterback, finished him off.
Great play by the defense. Pushing the play out, getting penetration, and stopping him from turning the corner. This is great assignment football by this defense.
Still haven't seen Garrett Green have to really let it go. That one quick incompletion on second down of this drive. Now five plays in, second and 10. And Green on the keeper is bottled up, just a gain of about half a yard. Third and close to 10.
You know, they're going to have to run him inside a little more because at this point, you know, they're not respecting going through the outside. You know, the defense is playing up on that, not allowing them to get the ball to the outside. They are keeping contained. Balling it up on the outside. Make him run inside on this play.
Green to throw. Pressure coming. And he escapes. Garrett Green picks up the first down with his legs again. An 11-yard gain.
That's got to be that's disheartening for a defense. There you play the game perfectly. You get penetration. You blitz. The blitz gets there, but not able to make a play on the quarterback. That's hard, man. That's tough, man, because you've done everything right. You just have to finish the deal and tackle the quarterback on that play.
So far, it's a much different looking offense when Garrett Green's in there at quarterback, but it's still been effective. Two first downs already.
More spread out.
Justin Johnson gets a carry and breaks up the middle with a flag down. Keeps moving the feet. It's a 13-yard gain if it stands for the freshman out of St. Louis.
We told you, man, they have to run in the inside because this point, the Sharks defense are not allowing them to get outside. They're balling up this
holding
team.
Number 50, offense.
It's the left tackle, Brandon Yates.
Still first down.
So first and 20 negates the big gain for Johnson, who is a true freshman on this West Virginia team. Played his high school senior season just a few months ago in the springtime.
Yeah, he kind of lassoed the defender on that play.
So still has not been a pretty game for the front five of West Virginia today. First and 20. There goes Johnson again. He breaks it up the middle, and he's back to the original line of scrimmage and more.
Run in between the tackles. Make those guys up front become physical players. Give him an opportunity to run with the quarterback and the running back.
Here's the tempo. Johnson again on second and 10. Rolls off a couple of tackles and gains about three. Third down and 7 coming. Dom Barbuto and Sean Kelly involved in the tackle, and Long Island circling in some players up front and in the back as well.
What we look for now, Jared Green has established a run. Now we look for them to go over the top and use those weapons outside as far as the wide receivers.
Third and 6. Green with time. On time for Isaiah Esdale, but it's out of bounds. Led him a bit too much. Had Esdale with first down yardage. Instead, fourth and 6, and expect the offense to stay on the field here the way Neil Brown's been calling it today?
Absolutely. He has to be more aggressive. He believes in an offensive line being able to pass block, but I don't know about running the ball.
Fourth and seven. So Green 0 for his first two. He has rushed for 25 yards on this drive. First series for the redshirt freshman.
One-on-one to the outside.
Needs the 34 on fourth down. Green pressured. Lets it go for Estill. He's got it. First down inside the 15.
Great pass. He's evading the pass rush. They were one-on-one on the outside on the corners. Give your athletes a chance. Gets out of there. Looks down the field. Back shoulder throws to the wide receiver. You want a young guy to go out there and play like that. He's a gunslinger. Give him an opportunity to use his feet, run around, make some plays.
So it's a gain of 27. And again, you see how plays don't die when Garrett Green's at quarterback. He extends him.
You hate that as an offensive lineman because the play never ends. You don't know where he is either.
Green keeps it. And he's submarined after a five-yard gain. Jaden Rowe, the junior safety, came up and hit him low.
I'll tell you what, they're getting penetration inside. Why not go out there and run the option play?
Joe Amalfitano, the preseason All-Northeast Conference. That's Joe Amalfitano being helped off the field. Long Island needs him if they want to be a contender in the NEC moving forward. All-conference player on the defensive line. West Virginia fans are open to see Garrett Green at some point today. They've seen the backup quarterback here on his first drive in the second quarter. And so far, it's been different than what you see with Jared Dagey, but it's been effective.
Right. You know, if you look at him, he has legs. He can move around. He's pretty fast. He's an athlete as opposed to being a bona fide quarterback. It's a totally different set of plays that he's running as opposed to what Dagey had. So they're using him to get out of the pocket, run around a little bit, and tell you the truth, the Sharks are running the same defense. They're blitzing a lot, but they're allowing him to get up and evade that pressure to push the ball down the field or even pick up first downs.
So that's 21-0 West Virginia, striking for more here. It'll be interesting to see if it's just a series or two or if the starters are already done for the day. We haven't seen Dagey or Letty Brown on this drive.
Well, if they go up 28 points, I think we won't see the starters anymore.
Johnson turning the corner near the first down marker. Give him a first down, first and goal before Ben Wyboga takes him down. And
if you look at it, I love the fact that they're running this offense with them.
So first and goal from the three. Green keeps it himself and he's in. It's the first career touchdown for redshirt freshman quarterback Garrett Green.
Great play. They run a misdirection. Get the ball to the quarterback. Uses his skill set. On this play, I love the fact that they have so many people running so many different directions that it's hard for that defense to really make the play. They got running backs and tight ends going in all different directions. They lead up with the tight end, and he walks in scot-free.
It's a good block by TJ Banks, who blocked really well at tight end last week for Maryland as well. They're still without Mike O'Loughlin, who is missing his second straight game, but he was back in a limited role in practice this week. Extra point is good for Legg. And Garrett Green leads a touchdown drive for West Virginia. Mountaineers 28-0 over Long Island. Mountaineers rolling in Morgantown, up four scores. Well, about 50,000 fans were expected here today at Pushcart Stadium, and it has been electric. Last year, Morgantown started with no fans early in the season. They got up to a quarter capacity, so about 15,000 come the end of the year, but there was no tailgating. You missed a lot of the pageantry. People were going wild when the band took the field before the game day. You missed that last year.
No question, you missed that. I mean, even when they made, you know, the band went out there and formed the state of West Virginia, it was electric in here. You look out on the side, you see guys tailgating, you see women tailgating. It's just electric being around college football again, being amongst the people.
See West Virginia's offensive efficiency, four possessions if you include the opening kick return, four touchdowns. Last drive led by backup quarterback Garrett Green, who rushed for 34 yards and a score. Shamar Paul calls for a fair catch here.
What was that? That was definitely a mistake. He's going to hear an earful from the special teams coach.
We'll bring the ball out like a touchback to the 25. So after two returns where he only netted to the 14-yard line, taking something a little bit more positive here in terms of starting field position. But for LIU on offense, let's talk about what's been good, what's been bad. They have picked up first downs on two of their first three drives, but they haven't been able to string first downs together yet with Camden North at quarterback.
Yeah, you know, you're talking about a defense, it's a 3-4 defense, but their speed and their athleticism is on the outside. So the more you try to run on the outside, you're going to bump your head against the wall because that's where their strength is.
Orth to throw here underneath for Stephen Chambers, and the senior from Garden City Park on Long Island gains about six.
Flag on the play.
There's a flag down, thrown right by the line of scrimmage. Haven't had many penalties today. This will be just the third time we've heard from referee Scott Campbell.
And those were man downfield, number 11 offense. He was covered up and went downfield on a legal forward pass. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
So that's the wide receiver, Oyakonmi, and that was really a formation issue there with the wide receiver getting covered up in the formation.
Yeah, you know, and you hate that because you can't hurt yourself. You know, you're already playing the game which you're down right now. You're trying to dig yourself out the hole. You can't continue to have those type of plays and take away negative yardage when you're, you know, basically you're behind the box anyway. So at this point, I think they need to push the ball down the field, play on the outside, run slants, run digs.
Jonathan DeBeek on the carry, and he meets Scotty Young. In a 3-3-5, Scotty Young plays what's called the spear for the West Virginia defense. A lot of defenses would call that the rover. He's kind of a hybrid linebacker defensive back.
Yeah, we called it monster in high school, but he's virtually a safety that plays linebacker, playing around the line of scrimmage, playing inside the box. He's there to stop the run and cover tight ends and running backs out of the backfield.
I got to say, of all the positions in football, that rover slash spear slash monster is the best name.
No question.
Second,
do it all.
Second and 13 for the Sharks. DeBeek again, big hole. Oh, it's a nice shoestring tackle that stopped DeBeek. Josh Chandler Cimito, the senior from Canton, Ohio, strong middle linebacker, saved what could have been a first down game.
Absolutely. You know, what they're doing is they're spreading them out. You know, they were tight and everybody was in the hash marks. Now they're starting to spread the offense out. They had a bunch to the right side of the ball, which allowed them to take a couple guys out of the box and run in between those tackles.
West Virginia really rotating its depth players here in the second quarter. Backup safety Kerry Martin Jr. in for Sean Mahone here. Seen Jordan Jefferson in for Akeem Messidor on the line as well. Third and 8. Worth has had time today. He lets this one go deep for Oyakonmi, and he overshot him. Oyakonmi had a step on Scotty Young.
You at least got to give him that type of threat. I mean, he beat the coverage. He just needed a good pass to get to him. He had actually beat the safety over the top and beat his man.
You see Jonathan Gill, who is also the quarterback's coach, has been the quarterback's coach for 17 seasons at LIU, speaking with his quarterback, who missed the best chance so far today for the Sharks.
That was a great, great route by the slot receiver on that play.
So Hurtline punts for the fourth time. It's another short one, and Maliushevich takes the fair catch. So that punt, 34 yards. And West Virginia with the football again, looking for a fifth score on five drives in Morgantown. Well, some of the headlines from around college football today. How about that win for the Ducks of Oregon at the Shoe over Ohio State, 35-28. And meanwhile, Notre Dame survived at home, scoring in the final minute to beat Toledo 32-29. If Brian Kelly was as unhappy as he was after the win in Florida State, I can only imagine how he's feeling after this one today.
Absolutely. It's beginning to be a lot of parity. You know, at this point, a lot of teams didn't have a lot of reps this last year.
Next Saturday, Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus has an action-packed day of college football. First at 2:05 Eastern, Nevada plays Kansas State. as Jarrett Dagey is back into the game and hits a quick 9-yard completion to Sean Ryan. So after Garrett Green got one possession, Jarrett Dagey back in. Two more games next week as well. 3:30 we'll see Baylor in Kansas and 7 Eastern, FIU and Texas Tech, all on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. So Dagey and Letty Brown both back in after getting a series off. Dagey looking to go deep. Here's a shot. Looking for Ryan. It's out of bounds.
I'm surprised they're back in, you know, considering the fact they already up 28 to nothing. They pulled the starters back in. I thought they would keep Green in just to give them some more reps, because it's going to be hard-pressed to get some reps.
Well, Barry, you wonder here, though, is we'll get a look at Ryan beating his man. Yeah, and you got Virginia Tech coming next week, Oklahoma the week after. And though the offense scored two touchdowns with the starters in there, neither drive was super crisp.
Absolutely.
Maybe looking to build a little more momentum here before they take him out for the rest of the game.
Yeah, you know, they just weren't satisfied with what they had up front. They weren't moving the ball. The Sharks played a really good game the first half against the starters.
Third and two. Letty Brown does just enough. He was working off right tackle, and Wyatt Milam, the freshman from West Virginia, is in at right tackle on this drive. Milam was a superstar recruit. It offers from everywhere, chose to stay home. His first game did not go very well. He had a rough start at right tackle against Maryland, but they're still very confident he's an NFL player down the road.
He's still young yet, you know, right out of high school. He's going to have to learn, you know, the point of attack is where the ball is won, where the game is won. So if you can win up front, and they're relying on him to win his blocks up front, you can move the ball. But at this point, you know, I think he's at a point where he understands, look, I have to play well in order for my team to be successful.
Brown gets 40 yards. It's second and six. Pulling it back on the zone read. Slant over the middle and a good pitch and catch. Sam James with the good gain for a first down as Dagey made the right read there on that run pass option.
And that's all set up by running the ball. Moving in between those tackles, running the ball, it allows you to pop up over the top and get it to your athletes on the outside.
Dagey pulls it out again. This one nearly picked. Well defended by Tyler Tobias, the senior from Pennsylvania, who got around the wide receiver, Bryce Ford Wheaton.
Ran a quick set. They're playing man-to-man. He just sat on the route. It didn't help that Dagey, you know, kind of looked at him the whole way also. So
a little more on Wyatt Milam again. Superstar recruit. Could have gone anywhere. Jared Parker said, hey, this is a game that 2 years from now he's going to look back on when he's an all-conference player and think, hey, it was a rough start, but boy, things went up from there.
Absolutely. You know, because he will be that guy. You bump your head and get those bumps and bruises early as a young guy, but it only makes you tougher. It makes you hardened when you go into being a sophomore and a junior, and now you're getting the notoriety that you know, that you worked so hard for, because you now know how to block at this level.
Brown on third and four, and it has not been easy going for Letty Brown. Matthew Molina stops him short. That is 13 carries for just 22 yards for the all Big 12 running back Letty Brown.
And you look at it, Matthew Molina and Anthony Lavelle, those guys are playing on the opposite side of the line of scrimmage. They are playing in West Virginia's backfield, which is allowing them to stop the run.
I don't think the Mountaineers are planning on kicking or punting today. It's fourth and two. Going for it again here with Jarrett Dagey at quarterback. Tony Mathis Jr. in for the first time. He gets the carry, lowers the boom, and picks up the first down. So he missed last week with an injury. Third running back in today. But the redshirt sophomore from Orlando with a tough run for 5 yards.
You just take it, one step down, boom, just go take it to him. Get the first down. Put your head down. Get the first down. Keep the sticks moving.
Six different Mountaineers have carries. The two quarterbacks, three running backs, and a wide receiver. On first and goal. Dagey under pressure and down he goes. Big Anthony Lavio, the redshirt senior defensive tackle, smothered him.
Love it. The big fella beats his man up front. And the inside goes around the corner. No, you can't block me with just your hands. I'm too big for that. I'm going to go make a play on the quarterback. Love it.
So second and goal now all the way out to the 18.
Straight hustle play on that.
Sharks showing blitz. Six at the line. And they're coming for Dagey again. It's picked up. Dagey over the middle, wide open, touchdown. Sam James.
Great protection. They run it in the seams, a straight go route in the red zone. Wide open on the play. They had it man-to-man, but there was a coverage mess up on that. He just ran straight by the defender.
18 yards, Dagey to James for the first passing touchdown of his season for the Mountaineers. And hey, we got to credit the big boys up front, right? They picked up that blitz.
No question, picked up the blitz. Didn't have anybody on the quarterback pushing him around. That's what you want. That's the team that he's been looking for to go into next week. A team that can block on the pass, run on run plays, and establish a line of scrimmage.
I'll take that fiver for giving the offensive line some love now, Barrett, or you can wait until the next break.
I appreciate that. Sometimes, usually you hear our name when we don't do right, but hey, at this point, I love the fact that they just took over this game and pressed the ball.
So West Virginia just on a roll at this point. Dagey to James. It's 35-0. Well, it's gone relatively smoothly for West Virginia. Kickoff return touchdown to start the game. 4 offensive possessions, 4 touchdowns since. Meanwhile, Long Island's been held to just 4 first downs on its 4 offensive possessions to start this game. Shamar Paul will return this one. And it's a good return out over the 20 and to the 27. Best field position today for the Sharks. See if they can get something going before halftime here. Speaking of halftime, coming up, we'll talk about how 9/11 was remembered around college football. We'll see how Neil Brown and his family got the whole team involved for a family barbecue, and we'll have first half highlights. I imagine we will see a whole lot of Mountaineer offense on those first half highlights. Camden Orth at quarterback, 5 of 9, but for just 17 yards today. West Virginia's kept everything in front of him. Orth underneath to Jonathan DeBeek, and that's one of the biggest gains of the day through the air. A gain of about 6 for the running back before Nick Troy Fortune pushed him out.
They have to challenge this defense on the outside. You know, we understand the athletes they have out there, but they have to make sure that they run some slants, run some digs, you know, take the top off the defense a little bit, at least give the threat of a pass deep, which will open up everything in the inside.
Junior Nick Troy Fortune, the quarterback, he's the hype man on this West Virginia defense. He provides a lot of energy for this group. DeBeek, traditional run this time. It's a first down. Oh, ball popped out at the end. Mountaineers are on top of it. And DeBeek is ruled down by the head linesman, Tony Wright. So give DeBeek the first down, a gain of 6.
Yeah, if you look at it, you know, it's nothing but a simple zone play. You know, it's just, I mean, a simple backside pull, double team the front side on the power, and run on behind those big guys up front.
It's officially an 8-yard gain. That's the longest play today for the Sharks on offense. Clock will start to be a factor here. Just 2:05 to go before halftime. Orth moving the pocket. He's looking for Owen Glasgow, and he missed him.
Oh, see, you got to make those type of plays. I mean, he was open on the play. It was nothing but a simple out route. He's got to hit that out route.
Again,
get him out running. Get the out route. Put it on his body. He beat the safety on the play.
Glasgow, really solid target for him. Transfer from Penn State in his third season with the Sharks. Told you earlier, this very meaningful day for Owen Glasgow. Lost his dad, Keith, a fireman at 15 months old on 9/11. It's Glasgow in motion. Pitch it to Kevin Wilson, the running back. Decent seam. Sets up third manageable 5-yard gain for the sophomore Wilson. Alonzo Adai, the safety out of Canada, there for the hit.
They've been running the inside because they're running misdirection. Have guys running around everywhere on that play. They pull the backside, option route to him, get the ball out to the running back, and he takes it one step, cut, going down the field.
Lance Dixon is the injured Mountaineer, redshirt sophomore from Oak Park, Michigan, who's been involved in a couple of key plays defensively today. So one thing you don't want ever, but especially in a game like this, when you're up 35 already, got a couple of your biggest games of the season coming up with Virginia Tech and Oklahoma the next 2 weeks, If you ask Neil Brown his goals for this week, I'm sure one of the ones high up on the list was get through this week healthy.
Absolutely on his play. He's the outside linebacker. He keeps running. And it's friendly fire that he gets hurt. Hit him in the ribs.
He ran hard into Sean Mahone, fifth-year safety. But he's off the field mainly on his own power here.
May have got the wind knocked out of him. Running to the ball.
Again, if you're the Sharks at this point, you're just looking to build any positive momentum you can here. LIU will get the ball to start the second half as well. So an important third down for them to keep this drive going, string a couple first downs together, maybe even get on the board before halftime.
Yeah, they're in four down mode. They have to go out there and at least put something on the scoreboard, at least try to. The only way they can do that is if they challenge them on the outside.
Derek Eugene's been very quiet today after 117 receiving yards last week. Orth's pressured, and down he goes. Flag comes out late. It may be a face mask.
Yeah.
Taj Alston got in there, but it looked like he had a big grasp of metal.
Personal foul, face mask, number 12, defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic first down.
So everything but the finish there for Taj Alston, and he gives a first down to the Sharks.
Yeah, he's getting blocked on the play, but he beats him. You know, it's actually holding on the play, but he was just trying to grab anything that he could because he was getting held on the play.
So this
is a great rush.
And it's now the deepest LIU has gotten into offensive territory all game long. They'll take a timeout here. Jonathan Gill talking things over, sensing a chance with a minute 41 to go for Long Island to get on the board here.
Yeah, he feels it right now because this is the most momentum they've had going into this game. They've established something right now, got the chains moving. At this point, West Virginia is trying to play almost a prevent type of defense. So it's opening up things in the middle a little bit.
A big week around the conference here in the Big 12. Battle for the Cy Hawk Trophy underway right now. First time ever, both teams in the AP Top 25, and they're both in the top 10. Got Oklahoma looking to bounce back after a shaky week one.
Speaking
by Tulane, 40-35. And then we'll see Texas and Arkansas, former Southwest Conference rivals, going head-to-head tonight at 7 o'clock. Iowa right now up 4 on Iowa State at halftime. But always felt like it was going to be a game that comes down to one possession late. Yeah, Iowa State had its traditional stub of the toe in week one, but survived Northern Iowa. The Northern Iowa always plays them so
always.
They
played them tough last year, too.
First down for the Sharks. Orth underneath finds Derek Eugene. Oh, it's a good hit. Scotty Young took him down immediately after just a 5-yard gain, and West Virginia takes timeout here. That's interesting. Makes you think the Mountaineers are hoping to get the ball back.
Yeah, they're trying to make sure that they stop him. As a defense, you want to keep the goose egg on there. But he drops back. He gets the ball out, a simple out route. Goes up and makes the play. What they want to do now is tackle everything in front of them on the defensive side of the ball. Corral everything in front of them and make the tackle.
That is the first positive yardage catch for Derek Eugene today. Again, he had 7 catches for 117 last week. He is now up to 3 catches for -1 yards today. His first 2 catches were for -6. That one was for 5. Not great for the yards per catch average there.
It's supposed to have a great game the week before.
It's like when you're a bullpen pitcher and you have that one outing where you give up 6 runs in a third of an inning and it blows up your ERA. On 2nd and 5. Orth's pressure. That's Messidor. Orth gets it away and survives the hard-charging Akeem Messidor.
They run sprint right option. Want to get your quarterback out on the outside. Give him a little bit of an opportunity to push the ball down the field. Get outside. Just too much penetration.
Boy, the coaching staff loves Akeem Messidor, freshman All-American last year. Originally committed to Syracuse out of Canada. And Jordan Leslie said he went to a camp. First time he saw Akeem Messidor, He's already a Syracuse commit. Syracuse coaches would not leave him alone. He said as soon as they saw him play, they knew why, and they found a way to get some time with him and bring him to Morgantown instead. Third and five. It's a tunnel screen and a first down. Well-designed play. Devon Wells picks up about eight before Alonzo Adai makes the tackle.
You know, it's a double screen. They got screened to the outside, and they run a little tunnel screen back on the inside on the opposite side of the field. They have the athletes to run it. They just haven't been able to break it.
Clock moving. Minute 15 to go before halftime as Long Island looks for its first touchdown today. Fourth moving to the right again. Wide open. First down. Steven Chambers' second catch today and the longest pass play today for LIU. Good for 13 yards.
Same thing. Sprint right option. Put trips on one side. Turn around and get the ball. Run a little stop in the middle of that bunch formation. Wide open on the play. Get everybody running one way. Stop right in the middle of the field.
Jonathan Gill takes timeout. First and 10 from the 13. 57 seconds left to work with. Sharks down to two timeouts remaining now. So plenty of time to work with those two timeouts and four shots at the end zone here.
Sits down in the middle of that field. Wide open. Sprint right option. They saw it the first time. He just couldn't get outside because he was getting rushed, the pass rush on that play.
Look, we talked to Camden North this week coming off the FIU game. It's a daunting start to the season for this FCS program, LIU, in its third year as a Division I school. They played FBS FIU. They play West Virginia here. They play Miami, Ohio next week. So three straight FBS teams to start. But we've been impressed by Orth, even though he's a tough critic on himself. He told us during the week he didn't think he played very well last week, said he has a ton of room to grow this year. Get the feeling that he'll be a very good Northeast Conference quarterback as this season moves along.
Yes, he will be. He has a skill set to do it.
Is DeBeek with him in the backfield. It's an option play. Pitch out DeBeek. Gains only one. Daryl Porter Jr., the cornerback, and X-Ree Lowe, the linebacker, both there on the tackle. Lowe finished him off.
I think they're going to try to run that play again simply because if you look at it, Orth had a lot more than he could do on that play. He should have went and challenged the defense a little more, ran up into the line of scrimmage a little more. That way, when he pitched it, he had the guys looking at him as opposed to staring at the running back and going and making a play on it.
I feel like he pitched it too early there.
Pitched it way too early.
Empty set on second down and eight. Pressure coming. Orth goes down. Akeem Messidor.
Are we going to get tired of saying his name? He will make every play in the middle of that defense if you let him. He's that dominant of a player. You can't block him one-on-one. They tried to on that on a slant stunt. He ends up getting up the field, one-hand bars the offensive lineman, presses him back, and makes the play. Phenomenal athlete.
He played outside a defensive end last year in a freshman All-American season. This year mostly on the inside in that nose tackle position. But on that stunt there, when he twists to the outside, you see those defensive end skills and his edge speed that he still possesses even
exactly.
From the inside.
The one-hand stab, he has the ankle bend to get around the corner, press the offensive tackle back, and then able to push off and get to the quarterback on the play.
Heck of a student as well. He was Big 12 Commissioner's Honor Roll in his first year at West Virginia, sport management major. And again, the coaching staff here has said, Neil Brown during the week said, I wish I had 11 Akeem Messidors. Then Jordan Leslie, the defense coordinator, said, how many guys do I have on defense? I wish I had 46 Akeem Messidors. Third down and 18. Sharks can get a first down at the 3. Fourth with time underneath. Eugene makes a man miss. Derek Eugene down to the 8. Timeout LIU. Decision time here. A 4th and 5 coming.
Great play by him. If you look at it, they allowed him to go out there and make a play because they only rush 3. They usually rush 4. They only rush 3 on this play. He's able to get a little bit of time. They double team on the outside and then get it out to your playmaker, Derek Eugene. Give him an opportunity to go make a play.
What would you do here? It's 4th and 4. You're down 35-0, playing with house money in a Big 12 stadium. And the kicking game is not automatic here. Inzerillo was 1-for-2 last week, 2-for-3 last season.
I think they're going to kick it, you know, just for a moral victory. But, hey, you know, as a young, you know, a young program, understanding what they're up against, you know, a Big 12 team, I would actually go for it, but I think they're going to kick ticket just to go in as a moral victory of not getting blanked in this game.
And that is exactly what it looks like the Sharks will do. I'm with you. I would have liked, you never know when you're going to need to convert a fourth and five
exactly
later in the year. But instead, Paul Inzerillo out to kick a 25-yard field goal and get the Sharks on the board. Oh, he missed it. It was blocked. Alonzo Adai came off the edge. Jackie Matthews off the other edge. Yeah, the Sharks come up empty.
Coach Neil Brown said this would definitely be a strength for this team from this point forward. Special teams. They've done it all. They've returned a kick. They blocked a kick. You know, it's not too much they haven't done. They pinned them inside the 20 three times. Right up the middle.
Oh, yeah. That's Jordan Jefferson, the redshirt sophomore, who split the middle of that line and comes through for the block. Messidor was there as well. Both of them just obliterated the long snapper. So Dagey to throw. Mountaineers want more and get a quick first down on the quick hitter to the outside in Winston Wright.
And at this point, you know, if you look at what they're trying to do, they're trying to get these reps, you know, two-minute offense. They're going to need this later on in the season. They need these type of reps to get better as a team and see what these tackles can do, young tackles.
No timeouts here, 30 seconds to go. It's a good floating pass from Dagey. Sean Ryan makes a man miss, and Ryan's inside the 40. It's a gain of 29, 23 seconds left in the half, and the Mountaineers go quick.
1-on-1 on the outside. You got to win.
Now Dagey looks in rhythm here. Hit as he throws, Dagey into space, and there's the first drop today by Mountaineer wide receiver. It's off Sam James's hand. Big issue last year. Now, the number that's been thrown around is that Mountaineer wide receivers this year caught at least 100,000 balls off jug machines this offseason. We talked to Bryce Ford-Wheaton this week. He said he probably averaged 250 a day for 9 months. I did that math. That means, in general, he probably caught 40,000 balls himself, about 1,200 a week or so.
That is crazy, you know. But, hey, you got to become a better player, and the only way you can do that is putting in the time.
Dagey going deep down the sideline, and he overshot Sam Brown, the wide receiver, into the game here late in the half. Tyler Tobias there on the coverage.
Here's a young guy that should have made the play. It seemed like he wasn't running full speed on the play. So this is a learning experience for both sides. You know, you have the Sharks right now, their defense trying to run prevent. Then you also have the offense trying to run 2 minutes.
So it's third and 10 from the 39. Can get a first down at the 29. 12 seconds left in the half. Dagey's pressured and escapes. Jarrett Dagey showing off the wheels, looking like Garrett Green there. A first down, gain of 12. They'll need a quick spike here. 5 seconds to go.
Functional mobility. That's what you see, functional mobility.
Dagey gets the spike. 3 seconds left, and this sets up our first look at the kicking team outside of extra points today, as Casey Legg come onto the field here to try and put a little exclamation point on what's been a very strong first half for the Mountaineers.
That was a nice drive. They executed.
Yard field goal for Casey Legg, who's 1-for-1 this season. He's made a 23-yarder last week against Maryland. And Legg nails this one to put a capper on the first half. 38-0 Mountaineers at the break. A dominant performance. Mountaineers score every time they've had the football. Only thing that stopped them is the halftime clock. 38-0 with Legg's 44-yarder putting it to bed at the half. Strictly business for the Mountaineers today on their way to their first win this season. In Morgantown, West Virginia taking care of business in the home opener. 38-0, the Mountaineers on top of LIU. Hi again, everybody. Bill Spaulding here alongside Barrett Brooks. We saw both of the top two quarterbacks for West Virginia. Jarrett Dagey had most of the snaps, all but one series, and he played very well.
Definitely. You know, he's an all-around quarterback. What he brings to the table is consistency. He's pushing the ball down the field as a passer. He does have functional mobility in the pocket. He elongates plays, getting it to his weapons on the outside. He's pushing the ball down the field. Look at that. That's what you want from your starting quarterback. And he turns around and throws a touchdown. This is him being the multi-purpose quarterback that they need.
Yeah, he was 12 of 19 for 205 yards in that touchdown. Meanwhile, Garrett Green, folks wanted to see him. He got one series, and you saw his dynamic of mobility.
No question. You know, he's a dual-threat quarterback, but he likes to use his legs more so than using his arm. He's a phenomenal athlete, able to evade the pass rush, pushing the ball down the field also. But, hey, everybody loves their backup quarterback. Harry Storrs right now on a run play. But I tell you what, Dagey is by far the better quarterback because he has the ability to go ahead and just play.
All right, second half coming up. When we come back, we'll hear from West Virginia head coach Neil Brown what he thought about half number one. All right, we got Neil Brown with us. Coach, you told us during the week that you want your team's identity to be a physical football team that doesn't beat itself. Did you see that in the first half?
Parts of it, man. We still got a way to go. You know, I was pleased how we came out of the gate. You know, we've had a chance to be special on our kickoff return unit, Winston Wright. We blocked it well. We got off to a good start. You know, we've scored every time we've had the ball. It hasn't been pretty all the time. I think Jarrett Dagey's played really efficiently. I was proud of that last field goal drive there with like 40 seconds to go. I thought that was a really good 2 minute. Not pleased with our inability to run the football. We've got to be better moving them up front. We're going to come out and really try to establish the run here early in the second half. And then defensively, I thought we played sound other than the last drive.
All right, Coach. Thanks a lot. Good luck in half number two.
Yeah, thank you all.
And we start half number two with West Virginia in the gray, kicking it away. Shamar Paul on the return for LIU. Good seam, and Shamar Paul is out to the 30.
Starting off the second half on a good note. Able to get a return, not pinned behind the 20 like they were the first couple times they received the ball.
All right, so we'll talk more about West Virginia's offense when we move forward. Let's talk about the West Virginia defense. So a miscue in the alignment there for West Virginia adds 5 yards to the return. You know, defensively for West Virginia week one, they got hit hard early, gave up those quick 14 points. But seemed to settle down after that. This is a defense that was one of the top defenses in the country last year. How have you thought about how they've played today holding LIU to 88 yards?
Well, I think they play consistent gap control. You know, when you have a team that runs the option, you have to make sure you play your gap and your responsibility in the defense. They've done that, shutting them down for the most part. So at this point, you know, just like here, he's able to get penetration and get a tackle behind the line of scrimmage.
Dante Stills, the senior from Fairmont, West Virginia, coming in. Good moment for his brother Darius and a handful of other West Virginia seniors from last year. Their senior day was canceled, so they came back, had a senior day ceremony at halftime. Darius looking for an NFL home now after he was released by the Raiders.
Yeah, it's a tough business, you know, but he has a skill set that he'll latch on to somebody.
Second and 12 after the 2 yard loss for DeBeek, who's gained 23 yards on 8 carries today. Camden Orth been rolling to the right all day long. Throws on the money right along the sideline. It's incomplete. He was out of bounds.
Yeah, he kind of got tugged a little bit, you know, but that's what you have to do. Camden Orth has to move out of the pocket. Have him boot to the outside. Get him out there running. He has functional mobility out there, so he does have the gifts to go out there and play. At this point, it's tough to play against a team where their strength is on the outside with the linebackers run as fast as they run. And the defensive line is now starting to set the tone and get penetration on run plays.
Saw that good coverage by Sean Mahone on wide receiver Tosin Oyekamne.
Looked like he was a little handsy, though. But they didn't call it, so I guess it's not a penalty.
LIU have to take a timeout here. Jonathan Gill was all the way out on the field, and I think he saw what you thought when it came to a little bit of contact on that last pass. Speaking with referee Scott Campbell as the play clock's winding down.
If you look at the outside, he's able to move out the pocket, get the ball down the field. But look, he's there before contact. He's there before the ball gets there.
Well, I think that might have been a good catch, too. That might be part of what Jonathan Gill was hoping for, was a review here.
Right. The ground can't cause a fumble.
Does he bring it in? It looked like he brought it up. Nope.
Still moving.
It was still moving when it came out.
Right call on the field. No review. Third and 12. LIU 2-for-7 on third downs in the first half. Fourth steps up in the pocket. Over the middle, it's broken up. Just phenomenal defense by Alonzo Adai, who's had a strong game from his free safety spot.
Great, great man-to-man coverage. Able to play over the top when the ball was in the air. Didn't have to touch him. This is a great, great play by the defense.
Most of the starters still out there for this Mountaineer defense, up 38-0 early in the third. And Adai's made three big tackles today, and that pass breakup to force another Paul Inzerillo punt. Oh, and this one is off the side of the foot again. Takes a bad hop down at the LIU 49. That is just a 16-yard punt.
You know, and it hasn't been good all day. Special teams has become the Achilles heel for this Long Island team. So, I mean, as they go forward, this is something they're going to have to work on for the rest of the season.
West Virginia has returned a kick for a touchdown. They've blocked an LIU field goal, and the LIU punting average is right around 30 yards a punt on five punts so far today. If you joined us even 5 minutes late, you missed Winston Wright Jr. taking it back for a touchdown on the very first play. Since then, the four touchdowns on four real offensive possessions, and then the field goal right before the break after the 30-second drive that moved the ball about 50 yards. Dagey at quarterback again for West Virginia. Handoff goes to Letty Brown. Get the feeling here we'll get a heavy dose of Letty Brown on this opening drive, as Neil Brown told us at halftime. He was disappointed with the run blocking and the running game as a whole in the first half. Really wanted to establish the run early here, build momentum into the game against Virginia Tech.
Yeah, this is just like their practice. They got to make sure they go out there and impose their will. He's emphasized this in the coaches' meeting when we talked to him. He's now telling guys, look, we went into halftime. We didn't establish what we're going to do it this time. And I think that's what they're going forward with now.
Brown was held to 21 yards on 13 first-half carries. Two carries here in the second half. He already has 10 yards and a first down.
Nothing but zone blocking up front. My man against your man. See who wins. And at this point, Letty Brown is just one step cut and taking it right downhill. Right up the teeth of that defense.
Brown did have two first-half touchdowns, punching a couple 1 yard runs in to cap off long grinding drives. Again, Dagey's been efficient. 12 of 19, 213 yards. We're seeing why the coaches say he has won the job ahead of Garrett Green, the way they think he can efficiently manage the offense. Here's a screen pass, and look at Sean Ryan do the rest. Sean Ryan to the end zone. 39-yard touchdown.
Set up all by the run. It was a run pass option on the play. Dagey read it perfectly. They were slanting outside on the run to the strength of the offense, and he throws the little screen pass on the outside, and then he just goes out there and makes a play. This is what you want. You want guys like Sean Ryan to go out and use their athletic talent and make plays like that.
Diggy's second touchdown throw. Sean Ryan's first touchdown catch. 44-0 Mountaineers. Three-play, 49-yard drive in a minute and 18 seconds. And Casey Legg puts this one right through. So that was a little more like it for West Virginia to start this half.
Absolutely. Now, Bill, you look at it now, I may think that you will get the second team guys in there because they established the run and able to go out and really play, you know, the brand of football that they want to run. Great, great play by Ryan on that.
Sean Ryan from 39 yards out. Mountaineers up 45-0. 45-0 after Sean Ryan's 39-yard scamper. Well, this feels like a historic day just to have the fans back in the building again after last year and have the pomp and circumstance back. And obviously a lot of history of this West Virginia program since the team debuted in 1891. Legends like Sam Huff, Coach Don Elan, helped open this field in 1980. Notre Dame, West Virginia in the Fiesta Bowl back in 1989. The great Dan Moses. Great career here at West Virginia before going on to the NFL. And most recently, that 2012 Orange Bowl win over Clemson when the Mountaineers just blitzed the Tigers 70-33. One of the things that Neil Brown told us this week was that he was trying to show his team that all was not lost off just the opening loss. He showed his team clips of the last couple Iowa State teams, Texas from a few years ago when they lost to Maryland. All those teams ended up still winning at least 10 games, still ended up getting into the top 10. And the goal's still in front of them as you see some of the best of all time who have played here at West Virginia. But
they're still in the mix.
Team, is that they've got all their conference games ahead of them still. You've got Virginia Tech in the non-conference next week. Still control what type of season it's going to be for this group.
Absolutely. You know, they have some teams that they're slated to win, but they also have some teams they're going to have to fight against. And these games like this where it's supposed to win, this is where you learn how to win. So, I mean, I like the fact they're still being dominant with this, you know, Sharks team.
Kevin Wilson in it, running back, takes the first down handoff and dips ahead for just one. Still seeing a mix of first and second teamers out there for West Virginia. Sean Martin, the redshirt freshman, in on that tackle. They love his length, his strength, and think he'll be an all-conference player by the time he's done here.
Yeah, and he played that way, too. Right then, he went through the gap, and when he started going one way, there was no way that that offensive line could stop him from going there. Penetration kills run plays, and he was 3 yards behind the line of scrimmage, stopping the puller, hitting him in the hole, and then making a play afterwards.
Got an injured player for Long Island down on the field, one of the Long Island offensive linemen. Being tended to by the training staff. LIU looking to build any type of momentum on offense, just 87 yards.
Oh. The nature of this game is a gladiator sport.
That was Ryan Charleston, the backup left guard, so he's being tended to. And the injury be taken care of. We'll step aside. So the injured player, senior right guard Julian Singh. And Barrett, I know you've been in these situations as an offensive lineman. A lot of bodies falling down at your limbs.
Definitely. He blocks back on the play. But then as the play develops, he gets pushed back and you get rolled up like that. That's one of the worst things about being an offensive lineman. People coming and hitting you from the back. My career was actually ended kind of the same way, where I ripped my patella tendon from my kneecap from a play just like that. A running back hit me from the back and a pile came on top of me. So it was painful to say the least. But, you know, hey, 12 years playing.
So it's 2nd and 9 for Long Island. Handoff to Shamar Paul. He fumbled it. Ball on the deck. And West Virginia recovers. Seemed like Paul thought Orth would keep it. Orth thought Paul would take it, and they left the ball behind.
Yeah, you know.
Sean Martin
bad
in on the recovery.
Fumble recovery made by Sean Martin.
It seems as though that wasn't a read option on the play. Actually, it was supposed to be him just keeping the ball. And, you know, the two didn't communicate right.
So Martin comes away with it. Long Island's first turnover of the year. And the starting unit will stay in for at least one more possession for West Virginia. Jarrett Dagey in again at quarterback. Dagey play action. Taking a shot for the end zone. Incomplete. Good coverage by Tariq Sneed as went up top to Bryce Ford Wheaton.
They try to run a crossing pattern over the top from one hash to the other. Slow developing route. He had the pass protection to do it. He just didn't finish the deal.
Justin Johnson is in it running back on this drive with Dagey. So Letty Brown getting a blow on this particular possession. Johnson on the carry, surges through a hole and takes a pop after a 6-yard gain.
And that's exactly what this offense wants to see. They pull the backside guard and the tight end around the corner. They were able to seal the inside, and the running back cut right off the seal block of the double team for great yardage on that play.
5 carries, 23 yards for Justin Johnson, freshman who had offers from a whole host of Power 5 schools. On 3rd and 4, Dagey over the middle. He finds a touchdown. It's Sam James again.
Play action up front. You ran the ball consistently the first play. Turn around. Then they run a play action again and go over the top. A simple little crossing pattern going over the hash, wide open on the play against man-to-man defense.
So Jarrett Dagey's third touchdown pass today, up over 260 yards. He's been efficient.
Consistency. That's all Coach Brown is looking for. Coach Neil Brown says, look, well, I want my guys up front to be aggressive, stay aggressive, and continue to try to run the ball to get these guys in that type of attitude from this point on. Because it's only going to get tougher as they go farther and farther into the season.
That's James's third catch today, his second touchdown grab, go along with one for Sean Ryan. Injured player down on the field for Long Island being tended to right at the goal line. We talked this week to Jared Parker, the offensive coordinator, about what they see that the fans don't see because they're not in practice every day when you're trying to delineate between Jarrett Dagey and Garrett Green. And what they said is that Jarrett Dagey just knows this offense really well, runs it well, and they said he clearly won the competition over the summer.
And you can kind of see just from what you've seen today, he's been pinpoint on the direction of which the offense is going. His read options, his RPOs have been on point. You know, when he's supposed to hand the ball off, he's been handing the ball off. He's passed, had some chunk yardage with his passing. He's shown that he's the leader of this team and running the offense consistently.
Here comes Casey Legg once again as a 44-yard field goal today. And perfect on point after 7-for-7 on the 7 West Virginia touchdowns. Mountaineers have scored every single time they've had the football today as they now lead 52-0.
Play action up the middle. Simple slant route right there by the seams for the touchdown. You know, and everybody loves the backup quarterback. Jarrett Green will be, they'll be screaming, Jarrett Green, we want Jarrett Green. At the end of the day, Dagey has shown that he is the number one guy, the starter, the most consistent quarterback, and he brings a lot of functional mobility at the quarterback position. He may not run as good as Green, but he still can go out there and make plays with his legs. But the biggest thing is he can pass the ball more accurately at this point in his career than Green.
Oh, look, it's going to be a constant competition. Garrett Green showed that he could do a lot with his legs today and made a nice pass off his scramble. We'll see a lot more of Garrett Green probably as this game progresses as well. But right now, Dagey's got the trust of this coaching staff and has done enough today to solidify that positioning heading into that game at Virginia Tech next week. What would you think with the different skill sets about at least having weekly packages for Garrett Green, similar to what we saw in the first half when he came in for a series today?
Well, he shows the ability to go out there and be an impact player on the offensive side of the ball. You have to prepare for a guy like that. And I think that's why they brought Green in. They want Virginia Tech to go out and practice, you know, those type of plays in which Green will come in on. It just gives you more and more from a defensive standpoint you have to prepare for when you're preparing for West Virginia's offense. You have a dual threat quarterback in Green, but then you have a functional dual threat quarterback that is able to go out there and run RPOs also in Dagey.
As Jarrett Dagey said himself, you know, at this point, he's played about as much college football as anybody in the country. He's made more than 40 starts in his career between his first stop and here in Morgantown. So he's seen a lot. You know what you're going to get from him as Shamar Paul is submarined down for a big loss. Jackie Matthews, the redshirt junior cornerback, up on the hit.
Yeah, that defensive line has really started to take control of the game. They're playing on the opposite side of the line of scrimmage on the Shark offensive line. They're creating, you know, penetration, which always kills run plays. So, you know, you take the ball out of the hands of the quarterback and make him throw down the ball. Make him throw the ball down the field as opposed to just handing the ball off.
And Barrett, second half is where you usually see these talent disparities really come to head when you get tired bodies in half two.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, these guys are starting to get tired. And then, you know, they got fresh guys going in for West Virginia. You get to play your younger guys. You got to get them an opportunity to go out there and get some reps. Quality reps, because they may not be able to play later on the season when they're playing against the more higher-powered type of offenses and defenses going into the season.
Redshirt senior Darryl Middleton combines with Sean Martin to bring down Kevin Wilson for just a one-yard gain. Set up 3rd and 10. Hey, credit the crowd that's still here in a 52-0 game, making some noise on third down in the third quarter.
Of course the students are going to be here. I mean, this is a great win by them. They lost the first game. They've shown the ability to come back and play at a high level in front of their hometown crowd.
Screen pass to Wilson, bobbled it, pulled it in. Would have been better if he dropped it. Loses right. A couple of yards before Kerry Martin Jr., the redshirt sophomore from Charleston, West Virginia, brings up fourth down.
Look at the speed of the defense now. Now they're playing on the opposite side of the line of scrimmage. You know, they have great linebackers that can go out and run with just about anybody in the league. You know, they're secondary. They're playing at a high level. Safeties are playing in the box, knowing that they're going to run the ball. It's just hard for, you know, this Long Island team to really compete at this point in the game.
Indorillo into punt to Gracian Malashevich. He gets a chance to return, and he is pinned down. So that is a punt of 27 yards, basically no return. College football action continues tonight at 7 Eastern on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus, with three more matchups as Texas Southern takes on Baylor. Southern Illinois travels to Kansas State, and Stephen F. Austin faces Texas Tech. For all Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus content, sign up at ESPNplus.com/Big12Now. Top 10 has had some interesting results today. You see that Ohio State loss. Texas A&M just eking out a three-point win. First down for West Virginia. Garrett Green back into the game for his second series at quarterback. And you see, outside of the Ohio State game, which we talked about already, what else there really jumps out to you?
You know, you're looking at the Clemson team right now that they're leading 49-3. That's a great game for them. But then you look at this Iowa State game. I mean, this is going to be a game in which, you know, I like the fact that Iowa State, one of the major competitors in the Big 12, is showing, you know, they're going to be another, you know, a team in this Big 12 that's going to compete to try to be at the level where they are with Texas Longhorns.
Would imagine Jarrett Daigie's day is done. Here's a quick hitter from Garrett Green to freshman Caden Prather. Oh, the coaching staff is so excited about what Caden Prather could become. Freshman from Maryland, came in at 6'4", 210 pounds, an ESPN top 300 recruit.
And silky smooth, got speed for days.
Now, Jared Parker, who also coached the wide receiver, said, hey, he is a freshman. He's going through things that freshmen go through, learning how to run routes better, learning about playing against top-tier cornerbacks. But they think he's an all-conference player by the time he's done. Out the other way, Tariq Sneed brings down Sam Brown.
Yeah, he's got a little bit to go as far as getting his college football body. You know, he's going to be good, but at this point, he's still young and doesn't understand what it is to be a Big 12 athlete.
Now, let's drop giving Garrett Green a chance to get into a rhythm through the air. Two quick passes for a combined 10 yards. And over the middle, he finds Sam Brown again. It's a first down, gain of 15 yards before Jerome Brooks, the safety, gets there.
Simple pass routes. They're running nothing but slants, you know, dig routes. Just getting the ball out of his hands early, giving him an opportunity to show his arm a little bit.
And to be fair, he's looked very sharp here after using his legs on the first drive. Green has Tony Mathis Jr. with him. Third running back who's played today along with Brown and Johnson. Mathis ripped down in the backfield. Anthony Lavio got in there for his second tackle for a loss today.
Well, they're setting him up right now. They're setting him up. Now, this is twice that he's handed the ball off on this read option play. I can see him now faking the handoff and then keeping it and running around the outside edge for big yardage, because the defense is so used to them giving to the running back right now.
Again, important for Green to get these meaningful minutes. He was great high school quarterback, elite 11 coming out of high school. So there have been high hopes for him. Just hasn't gotten extended playing time. Only played in the Eastern Kentucky game in the regular season last year, going 3 for 4. Picks his way forward for a gain of about 5 to set up 3rd and 8 from the 13.
He's looking good. They're running plays. It was they use his athletic talent. I like the fact that he's going out there, controlling the offense, running the offense like he belongs there. You know, there's no running around and people didn't know what's going on. He's directing this offense and making plays.
LIU takes timeout here. Did not like how they were set up their first time out of this half before a 3rd and 7 for West Virginia's second unit here. As they take a break, we will as well. Third down coming for the Mountaineers when we come back. Look inside the LIU huddle. See Rick Reinhart, the defensive coordinator, Jonathan Gill, the head coach. Barry, you got to credit, say, iron sharpens iron. LIU challenging themselves. It's your third year at Division I program, playing three straight FBS teams to start this season. And that's bound to put them in position to feel pretty good coming into league play when all of a sudden they're not playing FBS teams anymore.
Exactly. They're trying to establish a culture now to go out there and fight every single play. Never give up. Just keep on going out there and playing as hard as you can, consistent as you can, and make sure you go through the basic fundamentals of the playing this game. If they can do that, not to say it's a moral victory, but at least them getting in the going in the right direction and understand how to play this game at a high level.
They're down in seven here. West Virginia can get a first down at the six. Second drive today for West Virginia quarterback Garrett Green. Green keeps it himself, bounces to the outside. Garrett Green's in again. His second rushing touchdown today.
He's just so slippery. You know, they run the read option, and it's almost like it's a keeper because he knew he wanted to keep the ball because they had established the run and handed the ball off so many times to the running back that he knew he could keep it and get some huge chunk yardage on this play. Right then, the offensive line said, look, we're going to run the ball, beat you up front. Running back comes through the hole, leads on as a blocker, and he runs in, not even touched, for a score.
So with that touchdown, it's now the most points West Virginia has scored in the 3 years under Neil Brown, surpassing their 56-10 win over Eastern Kentucky last year. Chance here to make it 59-0 with Evan Stanley in to kick the point after this time around. So Stanley gets a shot, he slides it through. Hey, we gave Jared Dagey his due. Got to give Garrett Green his credit as well. He was very efficient on that drive.
Look, he's been led by the tight end going. And look at the finish. Look at the finish by the wide receivers. You know, they want to make sure he gets in also. This just goes to show you that Sam Brown feels, look, I'm going to press my guy and score with my guy. And he follows right behind him for the score. This is a culture that Coach Brown is trying to establish. A mean culture, an aggressive culture, and that this is the only way they can do it, by finishing the teams that they see that they're playing against, no matter who it is.
And Barrett, he finished with his legs, but his arm was featured on that drive, 3 for 3 through the air.
Exactly. You know, he started off, look, I'm a multiversal athlete. I can go out there, I'm a passer, I'm a runner, dual threat type of quarterback. This just gives not just this Long Island team something to look at, but it's also giving the guys that are going to play after this, the Virginia Techs, everybody else in the conference. You can't just prepare for Dagey. You also have to prepare for Green as a defense.
Well, and even with all the praise we have heaped to Jared Dagey today, this Garrett Green performance gives enough fuel to all the folks who want to see more Garrett Green as well. He's doing his part and continue to have that quarterback battle between Dagey and Green moving forward here.
I told you, the backup quarterback is almost always the guy that they love the most until he starts playing. But at this point, he's getting valuable reps right now, valuable experience that they might need him one day.
And we still got 21 more minutes to go in this game. 5:59 to play in the third quarter. West Virginia up 59-0. Yeah, next week it's Virginia Tech, and we saw what the Hokies did last week against North Carolina. Suffocating defense, slowing down a great quarterback in Sam Howell. This will be the biggest defensive test that West Virginia's offense will face so far this season.
Definitely. They set the tone early, establishing a defense that really choked out one of the better quarterbacks this year going into the draft.
Shamar Paul on the carry. Sweeps to the outside and gains decent yardage. Picks up 4, but just not going to get much going east-west against this Mountaineer defense.
I told you, the speed is on the outside with the linebackers. Yes, they have some guys up front that can create penetration, but the linebackers are what they're trying to feature. They're trying to eat up the offensive line with the guys up front and then allow those linebackers to go out and make tackles on the outside.
Give me a grade here for West Virginia's defense so far today. LIU still looking to get to 100 total yards of offense.
Well, anytime you can lay a goose egg on an offense, you know, you have to give them an A. But I'm going to give them an A-minus because the first half, they kind of got pushed around just a little bit to start the game off. But since then, they've been lights out.
Quick hitter to the outside. Oh, what a play on the outside.
Okay, Bill.
Charles Woods, the spear, nearly picked that off.
Okay, Bill, I'm going to have to give him an A now, you know, because they are running to the ball, making plays on the outside. They're not allowing this Long Island offense to do anything.
So your grading is rather fluid over there.
Yeah. I mean, I have a curve right now, you know. My teachers back when I was in college just gave me a curve. Well, hey, I got to give them a curve because these guys are playing
relentless right now, and they don't want to be the squad out there that gives up the goose egg on the score.
It's third and seven. Go for the draw play. Shamar Paul, nothing doing. That was snuffed out by Deshaun Stevens, redshirt senior backup middle linebacker.
You know, this is great by this defense also because they understand they have to play assignment correct football. Even though they're flying around, they have to make sure they go through and mark their reads, making sure they make the right calls and making sure they make the right plays. He stayed at home on the play, which allowed them to make the tackle. If he'd have ran out and tried to make a play somewhere else, then it would have been a problem with his defense.
I say this now knowing that it risks getting the angry tweets and texts if the jinx comes through, but West Virginia looking for its first shutout since 2015 when they shut out Kansas. 4:33 to go here in the third, and looking to part of a defense that can put a goose egg up again today.
Well, at this point, I think the offense will have to run the ball a little bit just to get that clock going. And, you know, they want to feature. They want to show some toughness. And how do you do that? With an offensive line, you run the ball, hit guys in the mouth. And I think that's what Coach Neil Brown wants to do anyway, is establish the run.
See their most points since that crazy Baylor-West Virginia game back in 2012. That was like Big 12 track meets at its best,
yes.
Say 2012, 2013, when every game was in the 50s or 60s. And Big 12 football games are generally higher scoring than Big 12 basketball games.
No question. We're talking about guys that didn't play defense at all back then.
Another drive for Garrett Green. Green keeps it. Hole open for him up the middle. That was a designed pass play, but he saw that six-yard hole. Picks up the six to set up second and four.
Good read because they played good defense on the outside. Tight man-to-man, which allowed him not to be able to go to throw the ball. But instead, he keeps it and then makes a play with his legs. This is hard for a defense, man, because it's almost disheartening because you've done everything right but stopped the quarterback.
Seeing depth at the wide receiver position as well. As Mathis churns forward. We have our third quarterback of the game in now for West Virginia. Freshman Will Crowder has entered for at least a play, and now he checks right back out. So Crowder came in for one play, made the handoff. Garrett Green right back out there again. We'll expect to see Crowder maybe a little bit more later on in the game, freshman from Gardendale, Alabama. But there's his college debut. He'll always remember that handoff to Tony Mathis.
Look, Mom, I played.
All right, third and one, Green back in. Green keeps it. Look out, Garrett Green down the sideline inside the 35.
Speed kills.
So he gets 24 more yards.
Yeah, speed kills, man. You know, he's just as fast as any of the wide receivers out there. Definitely as fast as some of these DBs, so... You know, as a dual threat and you're a defense, I don't know what you do. I mean, do you have a guy go out there and kind of green dog him? If he goes somewhere, you go and put a guy directly on him? Or do you sit back and just let him run around? It's hard for a defense to stop a guy like that.
And again, we are seeing the difference in competition aside, depth of this game, lateness of this game aside, but the difference in functional ability for Daigie and pure speed and running ability from Green here.
Absolutely. And looking at this, West Virginia has established a dual threat type of offense in which teams have to go out there and play. You know, you can't just say, all right, we're going to go out there and defend Daigie on the play, because now you have Green giving quality reps and playing in this game like he's a starter also. So when you go forward and trying to stop this offense, you got to prepare for both of them as a defense.
So I bring back the point that I brought up about a quarter ago, since we've now seen two more strong drives with Garrett Green here. Even if Jarrett Daigie is your starter and your guy, do you have at least a package or two each game where you're getting Garrett Green in there?
You definitely do. You have to. You know, he's shown to be that versatile that you have to give him some type of play, some type of reps, just to keep him going, just to keep him satisfied throughout a game. Plus, he's definitely a tool that you can use in your repertoire as you go forward.
And now he's read the zone read a couple times in a row for Tony Mathis. Pick up 13 yards on the last two carries and another first down inside the 20.
Now I think they go over the top. They can use the run pass option. They got the defense running up. They're looking a little tired right now. Now you go over the top on a pass play.
Seeing that wide receiver depth out there for West Virginia as well. Reese Smith is in the game along with Caden Prather. Sam Brown on the top of your screen. Green keeps it. bounces outside around Jerome Brooks. It's another first down and a gain of 10. That's your quarterback outrunning a safety right there.
Speed kills, like I said. You know, he's looking as though this was a tight competition going into, you know, the beginning of the year. You know, so these guys at this point are really 1A and 1B as far as starters. It was that close in training camp. So, you know, the fact that Daigie won, yes, he's the starter. But you look at Green at this point to come in and give great reps at any time for this West Virginia team.
And as you said, at minimum, enough wrinkles to force teams to prepare for him.
Yeah, you have to prepare for him.
Mathis this time, a patient run. Nothing ever open for him. Tyler Tobias and Rudy Silvera there on the coverage.
And we got to give the big fellas up front some love. You know, even though these might be secondary guys, they are out there playing and blocking at a high level. This is the tempo that Coach Brown wanted going into this game. Just coming off the ball, hitting guys in the mouth, moving the chains. He can live with this all day.
Redshirt sophomore Jaquay Hubbard's in there at left tackle. Wyatt Milam getting a lot of time at right tackle today as well. Oh, high snap. Long Island falls on top of it, and there's the first miscue in the red zone. Kweel Lumpkins recovers the fumble.
Well, once again, Coach Brown's not going to be happy with that. This is the first time they don't go in and score. And, you know, it's just a bad snap by the center.
Jordan White, redshirt freshman in there on this drive, and he overshot his 5'10 quarterback, Garrett Green. That's maybe one of the negative marks against Garrett Green. He doesn't have the traditional quarterback size at 5'10, whereas Daigie's 6'3.
Right, exactly. You know, that's one of the things that figured into, you know, him being a starter. But he has some athletic talent, athletic ability, and he's run his offense the way it's supposed to be run. Any play they get on, he's run it to perfection.
It's going to be the final play of the third quarter, a third quarter that saw West Virginia outscore Long Island 21-0 and open things up with a 59-0 lead after three. Well, they welcome the fans back. Still have Country Roads to come at the end of the day for the first time in more than 600 days for most of this crowd. Going to keep them in their seats for another quarter and getting to watch some future stars of the Mountaineers like Garrett Green into the end zone again. Fans back in a big way in Morgantown at about 50,000 at kickoff after maxing out near 15,000 last year. Tailgating lots were full about 5 hours beforehand. And I don't think a noon kickoff next week against Virginia Tech is going to slow that down at all. They've already sold that game out, 65,000 strong here. And as we talked about, one of the things that helps keep folks around here, particularly if you haven't been here for almost two full years, Country Roads at the end of the game. I know folks looking forward to singing that with, at this point, probably 30,000 of their closest friends, with West Virginia up 59-0 here. Good play in the backfield by West Virginia's Braden Dudley, freshman and defensive lineman, getting into the backfield here.
And that's exactly what this game is made for, to go out and get these younger guys some reps, get them out there, give them an opportunity after all the hard work they've had in training camp to now be able to go out there and get some quality reps against a team they're supposed to be like that.
And that's the big key. Jared Parker said, on top of, you know, guys you think are going to play a key role this year, you want to get as many people as you can into a game here, because even guys who may be a year or two away, give them a reason to keep practicing. They want to play.
And, you know, and they emphasize that in our meeting also.
It's another sack. Darryl Middleton, redshirt senior, 6'7", power on the line, brings down backup quarterback Kevin Malour, who just checked in at the start of this quarter for LIU.
They've got their playing at a high level, getting up the field, beating the guards, beating the tackles, creating havoc in the backfield. It's hard to run anything if you're LIU right now.
In Zerillo to punt, Grayson Malashevich sees it bounce at the 32. It's killed at the 34, so just a 25-yard punt. Next Saturday, Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus has an action-packed day of college football. First at 2:05 Eastern, Nevada squares off with Kansas State. Then it's 3:30. It's a conference showdown with Baylor taking on Kansas. At 7 Eastern, FIU plays Texas Tech. For all Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus content, sign up at ESPNplus.com/Big12Now. Barrett, I know you'll be at your alma mater for that Nevada-Kansas State game. What do you think about that matchup?
Yeah, I'll be calling that game, and I'm looking to be a very competitive game. You know, Nevada is not a slouch. They're going to come out and try to play very, very hard against this Kansas State team.
All right, right back to work. Garrett Green, fourth series, and he misses as he tried to hook up on the outside with Caden Prather.
You know, that's a hard pass to throw. This is a sprint left option. Now you're throwing across your body. This is where you learn if you can play this play or that play with Green. You know, open up the playbook for him, see what he plays best. That way you have a game plan as you go into the season.
It's 4 for 7 through the air for 67 yards. He also has 12 carries for 85 yards and 2 touchdowns. This is his fourth drive. First 2 ended with touchdowns. Last drive, a fumble inside the red zone. Tony Mathis bounces to the outside. Tons of green. And Tony Mathis Jr. picks up a first down. Again, important to have him healthy again. I beg your pardon, that was Justin Johnson, the freshman, on that carry. We've seen a mix of Johnson, Mathis, and Letty Brown. Something that is happening partially because of the score here, but something that both Neil Brown and Jared Parker said needs to continue moving forward. They can't have Letty Brown being the only running back to touch the football like he was against Maryland last week.
Yeah, he's their best player, but sometimes you got to give the young guys an opportunity to go out there and play. He wants to be your bell cow back and work him, but you need to see what other talents you have in that backfield to really give you an accurate barometer on how many reps you can give and divvy out to the rest of the running backs.
Johnson again for a 2-yard gain. Played his high school football in Illinois, and Illinois was one of those states that had a spring high school season, so played upwards of 10 games only about 6 months ago. Mentioned he had so many offers. He was a top 20 running back according to Rivals. Had offers from Cal, Indiana, Illinois, Louisville, Michigan State, and a whole lot more. Chose to come here to Morgantown and has worked his way up to the number 2 spot in the depth chart, partially due to Mathis's injury and still working his way back to full health, and partially because he's been really impressive in camp.
Very impressive. Look at the speed that he has, elusiveness that he has, and he works perfect in this read option.
This time he meets about 4 white jerseys straight up the chute. Frank Sokenis, redshirt sophomore defensive lineman, made the final tackle.
A lot of you still playing hard, you know, and that's what they were trying to preach in the third quarter. Keep fighting, keep playing hard, because this is a learning experience, you know, not just for West Virginia as they go forward, but also for LIU. You know, they're going to get into conference play, and once they played against big powerhouses like this, then they turn around and play against, you know, people in their conference. Now they, you know, have a leg up because they understand what it is to play against high-quality talent.
Green escapes the blitz, breaks a tackle, and picks up the first down. Boy, he is magic. Just finds a way to slip through so many tackles.
I mean, I know he's 5'10", but look how elusive he is and look how quick he is. They bring the blitz, he eludes the blitz, and able to go out there, and he's hard to take down. You know, it's not like he's a small guy that you could just knock down. He's tough. He's a tough runner.
Looking for his third rushing touchdown of the day. Scott Johnson with him in the red zone again. Be interesting to see if they let him air it out here as well, work on passing in the tighter window in the red zone. Instead, it's Justin Johnson picking his way down to the 5 for a gain of about 6.
Pads are still popping out there, and the offensive line is starting to control it a little bit. If you look on the backside, they hit him, drive him back, and he's able to, you know, cut off the blocks. You don't need to just drive him by, but hey, all you have to do is just put it. I play with Charlie Garner. Just put it, you know, put your hands on somebody, and he'll do the rest.
Barrett, I don't know if you saw big Wyatt Milam, number 64, the freshman right tackle there, taking out a little frustration from last week. He just drove his man about 11 yards, put him on the deck at the end of that play.
That's what it's all about. He's gaining confidence.
Yeah, he had offers from Alabama, Auburn, Florida, and more. Chose to stay home at West Virginia. He's going to be a great one. Green bouncing wide, made the first man miss. He's taken down just a touch shy of the first down marker. 3rd and 1.5 coming with a first down available at the 2.
Now maybe this time they'll give him an opportunity to throw a pass. See if he can, you know,
get the ball right in between the numbers of the wide receiver, because you don't have much of room out there when you're in the red zone like this and you're this close to the touchdown. So I want to see what they're going to run.
Looking to get over 60 for the first time since scoring 70 against Baylor back in 2012. Johnson right down to the marker. Needed the two. It's right where he got. This will be very close, and I think he may be slightly short. Free safety Larry Elder, starter still in the game for LIU, made the tackle. Fourth and inches, and the offense, unsurprisingly, stays on the field.
Yeah, you got to go for it. You know, Coach Brown has been doing it all game. Why stop now?
Green will check over to the sideline. He's trying to draw LIU off for the first down. It's Johnson. Not much there. Was it enough? Oh, this is going to be very close.
Very close.
Needed half a yard, and this is what Neil Brown was talking about. He should expect even his second-string offensive line to get him a half a yard every time against a team the size of LIU out of the FCS, and it hasn't come easy. They turn it over on downs. He didn't get it.
This is great for LIU. Coach Gill, one of those guys to step up, bend Boulder back, and stop him on the goal line, and that's exactly what they did.
So would you say the biggest question here for West Virginia coming out of this game, I'll let you answer it coming on the other side of this break, is the offensive line the biggest concern moving forward? We'll hear your answer when we come back. Line now, the biggest concern for West Virginia. Two cracks to get a first down. All they needed was 1 yard. Couldn't do it on two plays here.
This is definitely concerning. You know, too many white jerseys around the ball, getting too much penetration, flying around and making plays when this is supposed to be a blowout game. They're supposed to just keep going. Now, I know they're winning right now 59-0, but there's plenty enough to talk about when they get back and watch film come up, you know, next week.
And again, you said it's 59-0, but remember, it's Virginia Tech coming next week. It's Oklahoma the week after. And even the first couple scoring drives when the starters were out there for West Virginia, they were not controlling the line of scrimmage. Letty Brown held to only about a yard and a half in touch today. That's not going to get it done next week against Virginia Tech.
Absolutely. You know, they're playing against different athletes the next couple of weeks. These aren't the type of athletes they're going to play against, you know, in a little bit.
Kevin Malore in at quarterback, sophomore out of Smithtown, New York. Second drive for him, trying to create some space. He went under center on the sneak, but went nowhere.
Just a little bit of, you know, a little bit of room in order to run their offense, because they don't want to get caught on a safety, simply because at this point, this defense of West Virginia is playing on the other side of the line of scrimmage. They're getting 3 yards penetration on all these plays, and that'll lead to this safety if they allow them to do that. So I see why they're doing it. And at this point, they're still in danger of it.
Finnish freshman Edward Vesterinen is in a defensive tackle for West Virginia, helping plug up the middle here. First time we've seen Vesterinen, part of a Scandinavian setup that West Virginia has started to put together here. Also have Victor Wikström out of Sweden, a tight end we may see here in the fourth quarter. Neil Brown has really expanded the recruiting pipelines. They've developed pretty good feed to Canada as well, with Messidor and Adai leading the way there, finding players wherever they can find them at this point.
You know, you look at football, it's become worldwide instead of nationwide. And, you know, the more and more people get addicted to the sport like I am, the more and more countries you're going to have to go out and get athletes from. So, yes, I can see that.
So you're saying that coaches may need to get the JFK to Helsinki flight as part of their regular recruiting repertoire?
Absolutely.
Malore goes down at the one. Pressure from a lot of different spots. Deshaun Stevenson was in there. And
you got to press it down. This is going to be tough right now, man. They're going to have to punt. And the punting has not been good this entire game.
Yeah, and it's an understatement. Average now only about 30 yards a punt for LIU at this point. At the very back of the end zone, this is Inzerillo again.
They might just go ahead and just kneel on this.
To be Indrillo's fourth punt today after Hurtline had five. His average is 26 yards a punt. Malashevich has a chance to return from the 35. Grayson Malashevich inside the 30. chance for him to get some serious spotlight as well. He was a walk-on, but he's a guy that some of his teammates, like Bryce Fort Wheaton, say pushes them harder than anybody else on the group. And Malachevich likely see some time. Well, in the college football arms race, you got to have it at this point. A beautiful football center if you want to win recruiting battles. And West Virginia's come through with the Pushkar Center that is just a masterpiece. Invested about $100 million into it. State-of-the-art training rooms, locker rooms, weight facilities, area for the players to hang out as well. And again, this is just par for the course now. If you want to compete in big boy college football, you got to have that stuff.
No question. If you go out there with facilities that aren't up to par, you're not going to get the big time athletes. When looking at, you know, the Texases and the Ohio States and looking at their facilities, not necessarily what the school is, but more so what can the school provide for them.
Avarius Sparrow in at running back, and Will Crowder is in the game at quarterback and gets a chance to throw on first down. Will Crowder hits Preston Fox, the Morgantown native, who makes a catch here in a 59-0 West Virginia game. And after a handoff for his college debut, Crowder completes a pass.
No question. Now here we go. This is where you get all the young guys an opportunity to go out there and play. They've worked hard all summer in training camp. Now give them an opportunity to go out there and get rewarded for their time, their hard work.
So Crowder out with Avarius Sparrow. Crowder will throw it again, sling it to the outside. Another completion, spinning toward the goal line, and down at the one. Caden Prather showing off that strength.
You know, you look at it. They virtually have three different offenses they can run for all three quarterbacks. You know, you got, you know, he can go out there and run basically everything because he's functional mobility as a quarterback. But then you have Green. He's a guy that's a run pass option. He can run anything you want as far as running the ball, using his legs. Now they go out and crowd. He can go out there and be a passing type of quarterback. So you got all three in your repertoire when dealing with a team like West Virginia.
Nine receivers, six running backs, three quarterbacks so far today. Six ball carriers at least, with two quarterbacks carrying the ball. Up the chute and into the end zone. It's a touchdown for Avarius Sparrow and the Mountaineers.
Yeah, they got an earful from not being able to convert the fourth down the previous drive. There was no way that this offensive line was going to allow them to get any penetration and stop them from running the ball to score this time.
So the redshirt freshman into the end zone. The Mountaineers are up over 60.
He barely got touched until he got into the end zone. The big fellas up front say, look, we are scoring, period, point blank. Put your guy in the end zone, that way we know we score.
Nick Malone opening up that hole at left guard. And here's Evan Stanley for his second point after today. Stanley handles the kickoffs as well for West Virginia. And again, Evan Staley sticks it through. 66-0 after Avarius Sparrow puts it in. Well, West Virginia has scored so much, we got to do this double time. 66 push-ups coming at you twice as fast as they were in real life. I'd like to tell you that guy could do 66 push-ups at that speed. I think we save that for Barrett up here in the booth.
Well, no, you know, I've been in the wrong end of one of these whoopings before, man. We played Washington one time, and they used to have a Husky every time they scored come out and run from the 30 for the 30. By the third quarter, the Husky wouldn't move, man. It was dead tired, tongue hanging out.
Speaking of tired, Evan Staley's got to have a tired leg here. That is his 11th kickoff of this game. Nine touchdowns, a field goal, plus the kick to start the second half. All right, let's look around the Big 12 scoreboard. Yeah, you know, Kansas hung with Coastal. I think that was a closer game than what the final score
a little moral
signifies
victory
yesterday. Oh, a grinder for Oklahoma State there against Tulsa.
You look at, man, Iowa State falling to Iowa. That was a big win for Iowa.
And Iowa State continues to struggle against Iowa. Looking elsewhere, Baylor out quick, Texas Southern, Kansas State all over Southern Illinois and Oklahoma. Hey, defense, yeah, it's Western Carolina, but so far bouncing back with the goose egg so far. And Texas trailing early, down 13-0.
That's huge. The Razorbacks stepping up to the plate, playing against a Texas team.
See what Steve Sarkisian's squad has in store for the remainder of this game. If they can figure things out, a Texas loss here might Maybe you look at how the Big 12 may shake out a little bit differently. Still feels pretty wide open, especially with Oklahoma's struggles week one, with Iowa State losing here after not looking particularly good last week, and Texas' struggles as well.
You know, Coach Brown stated that. He said, hey, we have some teams we should beat, but there's also some teams that, you know, is going to be a tough one. You know, this may open it up a little bit.
Kevin Mellor, a throw, nearly intercepted. Perfect jump there from the quarterback, Andrew Wilson Lamp, a freshman, getting playing time in the fourth quarter.
You know, he read that all the way. He played back perfectly on that play. He diagnosed it, sat back, and waited to the very last second. You know, I think that's why DBs play wide receiver. Wide receivers play DBs when they can't catch, because that should have been to the house. He read it perfectly.
Easy for you to say when your hands are like frying pans.
Well, mine's like stone. That's why I played O-line.
Third and nine for Long Island. Had a couple big third down conversions early in the game. Moved the sticks a few times. Have not converted a third down here in the second half. Dominic Jennings in it, running back. Mellor to run himself and just slide for a loss of one. And once again, LIU goes three and out. Any positives they could take from the first half somewhat vanished on him here in the second half.
I don't understand the sliding. You know, maybe stick your head in there and see if you can get some extra yard. Make somebody miss.
Paul Inzerillo on the punt. He is averaging 29 yards a punt. Justin Hertline averaged 28 a punt over the first five punts today. So that's something LIU is going to need to sort out moving toward conference play. You cannot give field position away like that.
This has been the decided factor of this game. It's probably been the biggest factor.
Malashevic takes a fair catch. Well, it was nearly 73 for West Virginia. Almost a pick six for the freshman, Andrew Wilson Lynn. Mountaineers up 66 at this point. You still wonder how many questions Neil Brown actually got answers to in this game. But as we look ahead, we'll get some answers real soon. Number 19, Virginia Tech here next week. A noon start, then at Oklahoma, number 4 team in the land the following week, Barrett.
I can't wait to, you know, this is going to be a healthy competition in the Big 12, considering the fact of what's going on, what happened today. Iowa State losing. Texas down by 13 to an Arkansas team. The Big 12 is up in the air.
Do you feel like West Virginia answered a lot of questions this week, or are you still left with questions going into next week?
I have less questions about their defense. They can roll anybody in there and they can play. They have depth at the defensive line, secondary, and at the linebacker position. My biggest thing is the offensive line not playing up to the capabilities I think that they should play in order to compete in this Big 12. You know, Coach Brown said it. These guys up front have to play better, have to play more aggressive. And I didn't see that for a major part of the game. This is an FCS school. It shouldn't have been as prominent that they could stop the run like they did and were able to do in the first half.
And again, to be fair, this is not James Madison, a team that came in here, played a seven-point game a couple of years ago. LIU picked seventh out of eight in the Northeast Conference this year.
Right. You know, they're going to go against better competition up front. Better competition against this defensive line, you know, so they have to do better. Next week, they're going to have a team come in who can play. Virginia Tech have great guys up front.
Marquon Rucker in at running back on third and two. Rucker, oh, look at that bounce to the outside. Got himself close to the first down marker, I think just a bit short. Set up fourth and less than a yard. West Virginia hasn't punted yet today, and I don't imagine we'll see them punt now. No. Keep the offense on the field.
Yeah, they will keep it out there and make those guys up front make their money. I'll tell you what, if they don't make this, they're going to be a very unhappy head coach come time to watch film.
As unhappy as he can be in a game you win by 66
points. Right. You know, it's tough as a coach to go out there and really, you know, say, hey, guys, we sucked up front when the score is 66-0. But in all actuality, they did not establish a run, and that was a major point of emphasis throughout practice.
Flag is down. Sparrow may have just gotten enough. It's about to be close, but let's wait on the flag. Again, very borderline. They didn't get that dominant push they were looking for there.
They emphasized it a lot in the coaches' meeting. They were looking for it.
Early on the field was the runner was short of the line to gain. Illegal formation. Offense, more than four in the backfield. That penalty will be declined. Turnover on downs, first down, Long Island.
And even the crowd here with its team up 66-0, not all that pleased about the fact that they can't get half a yard. And they'll turn it over on downs for the second time. All right, so that's not a positive way to end a second half that has been incredibly dominant. How about this? Here are the total yards in half number two. West Virginia, 248. LIU, -7. -7 yards in half two for Long Island. In the game, 555 yards for West Virginia, 81 for LIU.
The defense is back on track, setting the tone, not allowing this offense to do anything, as they shouldn't. But I'll tell you, on the offensive side of the ball, they have a lot of work to do with the offensive line, with them going out. And they wanted to be a team that they wanted to really set the tone and run the rock this game.
I know that was the second and even part of the third team offensive line there, but it was not like it was smooth sailing with the first offensive line. The pass protection's been very good.
Yes,
but they did not create big holes for Letty Brown either.
We are talking about, you know, I'm not going to say inferior athletes of Long Island, but I will say this. These are not the same athletes they're going to see next week against Virginia Tech. We're talking about cream of the crop athletes, athletes that can move around and dictate tempo to an offensive line.
And interestingly, so Garrett Green had 98 yards rushing on 14 carries. You take that out, West Virginia as a whole, 41 carries for 95 yards. That's only about 2.5 yards, 2.3 yards a pop against an FCS team that gave up 12 yards a carry last week to Florida International.
Florida International. Yep. So when you look at this, he's going to break it down. He's going to break it down just like that. If you take the quarterback runs out of it, the offensive line did nothing to help Letty Brown play at a high level. They were getting pushed back, and a lot of the times LIU's defensive line was playing on the other side of the line of scrimmage. They had a lot of impact plays. Impact plays mean, you know, tackles in the backfield, tackles for loss.
Hey, you played on some really good offensive lines. You played on some offensive lines that weren't as strong. What do you do in a week after you have a week like this to try and get things in a better position? As that is a huge hit, and a flag will come out.
Well, that was a tough play. You know, you want to stay aggressive, but you can't go out and make costly mistakes like that. It'll keep the chains moving, and you just don't want that. You know, he's not a dirty player, but, you know, he was trying to finish the play. But at this point, you know, you can't make mistakes like that.
It was Caleb Coleman, and the question here will be, was that just a late hit, or is it going to be targeted?
Personal foul with targeting.
Yep.
Number 16, defense, 15-yard penalty from the end of the run, automatic.
So it's targeting for Coleman as well. They'll review it, but if it's confirmed, that means Coleman is also out for the first half next week as well.
Yes, you know, and, you know, he's just trying to finish the play. He comes downhill. He sees and destroys. And, yeah, I mean, it's a targeting. He led with the helmet. He tried to lead with the shoulder, but it was head contact. And you just can't do that.
Now, again, he is the third string safety, so it's not like that really affects the game plan going into Virginia Tech if he's out for the first half. He's somebody out here trying to make a big play, but not only was that hit late, it was helmet to helmet as well.
Yeah, it's another coaching point, you know, another coaching point that Coach Brown is going to have to discuss with this team, even with a 66-0 route over an FCS school. You know, but you talk about what this team needs to do as far as, you know, dictating tempo with that offensive line and really getting those guys going up front. Well, you got to do the little things. Maybe you go out there and run a little Oklahoma drill. That's when you have three offensive linemen against two defensive linemen, and you just drive block to see who can get those guys out of, who scores. You know, allow your running back there and just come off the ball or just go one-on-one, man-on-man. Get them underneath the sleds. Make them push the sled. You have to go out and be successful in running the ball if you want to compete in this type of football.
Well, Senator Zach Frazier told us that it was a hard week of practice this week after they were disappointed with the Maryland game. I imagine the offensive line is in for another very intense, very physical week of practice.
There will be some tired guys on the offensive line
come this week during practice. They may go pads a lot more than they even usually do during the season, because they have to make sure that this offensive line really turns it around and becomes a dominant force for this team. Without a dominant offensive line, it's going to be tough for them to compete in the Big 12.
Again, still reviewing to see whether or not that was targeting. And here comes the decision.
Confirmed, number 16 has been disqualified.
So Campbell disqualified. He'll sit out the start of next game as well. Redshirt freshman out of Phoenix City, Alabama, and Smith Station High School. Transferred in from Hutchinson Community College. So trying to make an impact.
Trying to make a play. But you have to be disciplined. You know, and that was a big thing they wanted to also do. Stay disciplined.
Keep it on the ground here. Sharks get a good chunk of yards. With another flag coming and another late hit. Similar spot right along the sideline.
Same instance, too. Guys are trying to finish plays, but you have to see where you are.
Personal foul. Late hit out of bounds. Number 25. Defense. 15 yards out of the end of the run. Automatic. First down.
It's Devon Wells, the wide receiver, in playing quarterback on that snap. So it's a wildcat look. Wells already gained 11. You add on 15 more, and all of a sudden, the goose egg is in jeopardy here.
Yes, it is. And I keep saying it, though, but it's really coaching moments for, you know, Brown. You know, Coach Brown is going to have a lot to talk about. You know, this is going to be a team where they're going to go in after this game, and there's not going to be a lot of celebrating, simply because they didn't accomplish what they set out to accomplish on the offensive side of the ball. They did on the defensive side of the ball, but these penalties right here are going to set them back also.
Maybe the last play of the game, Devon Wells is smacked. So, West Virginia preserves the shutout. And the Mountaineers put up 66 points for their first win of the season. 66-0 over LIU out of FCS.
West Virginia came with a purpose. They came to win the game. A lot of coaching points they'll have going into, you know, next week's game. Defensive side of the ball came out, was aggressive. Everything you want from the defensive side of the ball.
Yeah, I think it's fair to say today played out close to as expected. But we will learn a whole lot more about this Mountaineer team in the next 2 weeks.
Absolutely. And I look forward to hearing what the coach says on Tuesday when he does his press conference.
All right, here, let's soak this in for the first time in almost 700 days. Close to 25,000 still on hand to hear Country Roads.
Take on until you all my.
Well, another one of those seminal college football moments a lot of folks have been waiting for over the past 2 years. West Virginia sending the folks home down those country roads happy after a 66-0 win.
Impressive win, definitely. A lot of coaching points that they can leave away with. But at the end of the day, they got the win, got the victory on the team that they should have beat.
Again, the offense got it done a number of different ways. You had Jarrett Dagey very solid through the air, 259 yards, three passing touchdowns. Garrett Green did it with his legs, 98 rushing yards and two touchdowns. He got four series at quarterback. And then Will Crowder, one series, moved a couple good completions and set things through. Get things rolling all the way on to that final touchdown. Let's look at the quarterback comparison today, starting with Jarrett Dagey.
Able to evade the pressure, go out there and make a play with his legs, functional mobility at the quarterback position, and he can run his offense to perfection. Gets the ball out on time, gets it out to his weapons. And that's what you want, you know, as a quarterback.
Couple really strong throws, Sean Ryan, and then Sam James for a couple quick touchdowns. Found James for the first touchdown as well. Meanwhile, it's a different animal when Garrett Green's in the game, but he makes things happen with his feet.
Great athlete. Understands, you know, his purpose is to use his legs when any type of pressure comes to him. But he also has an arm in which he can score also with throwing the ball. A dual threat quarterback. And this is another guy that you have to prepare for as a defense when you're playing against this West Virginia team.
I'm telling you, I think getting both those quarterbacks in the next couple games is an important part of the next step for West Virginia.
Yeah, absolutely. They have to have a package for him, you know, and he's good enough that at any point you could put him in a game and it not drop or miss a beat throughout the game.
And then how about that West Virginia defense? They end up giving up 11 yards of total offense in the second half. It wasn't the negatives for a while. 11 yards of second half offense for the Mountaineer defense.
You know, absolutely. You know, and Coach Lashley, he wanted to make sure that those guys played quick, fast up front. He alternated those guys up front, and he allowed his playmaker to make plays. You know, a lot of the times you see the defensive line, they'll get double team and triple team, which allows the guys in back of them, the linebackers, to make plays. And that's exactly what they were able to do. They were flying around, making plays, played assignment correct football against an option team, but still was able to make an impact and keep them from scoring.
So Jarrett Dagey, Garrett Green, and the rest of the Mountaineers take care of business. It started on the very first play, a Winston Wright kickoff return for a touchdown. Never looked back from there. A 66-0 victory for the Mountaineers over LIU. Just putting this game to bed. They led 38-0 at the half, kept on going from there. Thanks for joining us on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. For Barrett Brooks, I'm Bill Spaulding. Once again, the final score, West Virginia 66, LIU nothing. All games airing on the ESPN networks are streaming live and archived on the ESPN app. This has been a presentation of ESPN. Good night from Morgantown.